Welcome to the very first Imbali Live of 2020. My name is Helen Herimbi, and Imbali started out as a way for us to give key players in South African music their flowers while they can still smell them, as well as give them a platform to tell us their stories. So if you would like to tweet about today or Instagram or all of that good stuff, the hashtag is hashtag Imbali Live. But what I would really like for you to do is to go to youtube.com/Helen Herimbi and hit subscribe. That's what I would like for you to do. But and also I would like for you to turn your phones to silent. That would be, was it you? Oh, that would be great, thanks. So today's Imbali Live guest has taken South African rap to new levels. See what I do there? He is also known as he's also known as Bova, aka Third World Boss, aka Super Mega. Please put your hands together for aka.
Yeah. What the fuck is up?
So you're on this side?
I'm on this side.
Yes.
Soft.
Thank you very much for visiting us today.
Sorry that I was late.
Ish, do you guys forgive him? Is he forgiven? Okay, you'll have to forgive him today.
This is my drink.
Yes, it certainly is.
Watermelon or what?
Zola, what is it? So.
Aside.
So, you know, when I was thinking about how to introduce you today, I was like, I'm going to do the thing that everybody always does, which is try to like have a little play on the AKA-ness, you know? And I did that because when I was growing up, people would always be like, oh, Helen, like Helen Zilla. And when I was a bit younger, they'd be like Helen Suzman, you know?
Right.
So I wanted to know about what people used
Helen
to...
Helen Joseph.
You know? Showing your age. So what did you used to answer to when you were a beginning?
When I was young?
Yeah.
Well, it depends on who was calling me.
Okay, what did your mom used to call you when you were young?
My boy.
My boy. Aww.
Yeah, or just Kiernan or my boy.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was no... You know, my parents gave me a very unusual name. So my name is actually... It's not Kiernan. My name is actually Kiernan.
Kiernan?
Yeah, Kiernan. My dad was a sports fanatic. He is still a sports fanatic, and he named me and my brother after sports figures. So I'm named after some rugby player person.
Oh,
yeah,
that's very interesting.
And my brother's name is Stefan. He's named after a tennis player, Stefan Edberg.
Oh, damn.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So I remember speaking to you years ago, and you said when you were growing up in Cape Town, because that's where you were born, right?
Mm-hmm.
When you were growing up, it used to basically be like all these 42-in-1 games,
yeah,
and mix a drink.
Yeah, mix a drink.
What the hell is a mix a drink?
Mix a drink.
Do you guys know mix a drink?
Not drink or pop. Mix a drink. So my grandfather would we'd had this cabinet, and we had this it was like concentrate, you know?
Yeah.
And you know, that was when my dad, before my dad made any money. So when I was born, my dad was broke. And then by the time my brother was born, my dad had some cheese.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
you moved up to Oros.
So then we moved up to Oros. And eventually we ended up with Woolies.
You know? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So another thing that used to happen when you were a kid in Cape Town is your grandparents used to wheel you out, like, come and sing,
yes,
for the people,
yes,
right?
Yes, 100%.
What was your go-to song that you used to perform for?
My go-to song was... Any of you okay? Yeah, you know.
Yeah.
So one of my favorite memories is the first album that I ever listened to was Michael Jackson Bad, right? Which is very fascinating because Michael Jackson is my dad's generation of music, and also my generation of music, and hopefully will be my daughter's music as well.
Yeah.
For me, I was always the show-off child. So I'm the first grandchild on both sides, on my mom's side and my dad's side. I used to... my first little trick that I learned was to read. I can read really fast.
Show me time.
Yeah, so... So I can read really fast, and that was the first trick that I learned about how to get attention. That's when I figured out that, oh, it's nice for people to pay attention to me, to have like something to be able to do and for people to be able to watch me.
Yeah.
So I was maybe 6 years old, and my mom got me this, I don't know if you guys know Inkatha, like encyclopedias. So back in the days, people used to knock on your door and sell you encyclopedias. Is that still a thing? Do you guys even know what I'm talking about?
People have Wikipedia now.
Yeah, so then I think that was the thing that changed my life. So she got me this set of encyclopedias, and her dad is a principal. So they'd say, "Kiernan, come read for us." The African antelope. So like that was my first expose into what it feels like for people to watch me and to get attention.
Yeah.
And obviously then it progressed into music. So at my grandparents' house, there used to be like a lounge, and then there was steps, and then I was like, okay, put the music on. And then I just like jump and like stand and like sing, and yeah, man, that was my vibe.
Yeah.
And they'd make me do it every Sunday without fail.
Yeah.
And I enjoyed it.
So then you moved from Cape Town.
Yes.
And I think this is 94, right?
When your 1995, yeah.
So you guys moved to Johannesburg. And
Thank God.
And does that performing then stop, or is it something that continues, like you are now this performer?
Oh, man, it continued. I was always a show-off. I don't know if you guys can tell, you know. I've always been, you know, I'm very grateful to my parents and that they raised me in a way that I always thought I was a special child.
Mm.
I've always thought of myself as a special person. You know, even today, it is nothing material that makes me feel special about myself. I always had it in myself that I was going to be a special person, or that I am a special person.
You know?
So we moved to Joburg in 1995. And it just continued, man. I was always listening to music. I was always dancing. I was always singing. My dad and my mom, our family, we used to throw the sickest house parties, bro.
Yeah.
Sickest karaoke, you know?
Lots of Michael Jackson.
You know, once, three times a lady. Yeah. I love you, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, real colored shit, you know?
Okay, so at that point, you know that you are this special person, right? Or you're going to become an even more special person. But what do you think your future is going to look like? Are you thinking, I'm going to be a musician? Are you thinking, I'm going to be a doctor? Like, when somebody says, Kiernan, what are you going to be when you grow up?
I used to tell them, so what I actually always wanted to, so my dad was a programmer, actually. My dad did coding.
Oh.
Right, back in the days, right? In fact, I don't know if you guys know, do you know LES's dad? His dad is the first black person to work for IBM in South Africa. You guys know that?
Yeah.
So my dad was part of that like era. So, you know, back then in those days, there were like only like 5 people of color, like total, who like would work for like IBM. So my dad worked for Anderson Consulting before they became Accenture, right? And he was a programmer. So what I wanted to do is, because I like, still to this day, I play video games. I don't think I will ever stop playing video games.
Yeah.
I love video games with all my heart. Like, I love PlayStation, like, so bad. In fact, I might get a tat. That's how much I love it.
Oh, wow.
And I always wanted to, be a programmer.
Mm.
Until I found out how much maths was involved, and how much science was involved.
Yeah.
And then that dream kind of just fell away. And then I wanted to be David Beckham.
Mm-hmm.
So this is, you know, David Beckham was my hero.
Oh, wow. Because
he had Posh Spice, that was his honey. And
still is.
Yeah, still is his honey. And I wanted to be a soccer player as well. I can ball, you know, brain knows.
Yeah.
You know.
Okay.
Yeah. So I wanted to be a soccer player, and then Eventually, I downloaded Fruity Loops one day in the year 2001.
Yeah. So then you're in like Standard 6.
No, in 2001, I'm in... You see, you're showing your age now.
Oh, but people
still
know.
Call it Standard 6.
Guys, okay, grade 8. You're in grade 8.
Grade 8, yeah. Yes. And then I downloaded Fruity Loops one day and the rest is history.
Yeah. Well,
that's very poetic. People always say stuff like that.
Yeah, but we're here to unpack some of that history. Mm. So it's 2001. You download Fruity Loops.
Every time somebody says 2001, I always think bling, 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 bling.
Yeah. So then, are you writing rhymes at this point, or are you only making beats?
Oh my God, my first raps were so whack.
Tell us, how did they go?
I don't remember. But I wrote my first rhyme in... Shit, I think I wrote my first rhyme in the year 2000, I think.
Yeah, so before you started
in the year 2000. Remember, people thought like cars would be flying and
in
shit.
In the new millennium.
Yeah, it's cars still ain't flying to this day.
So then you were writing these rhymes.
Yeah, I wrote my first rhyme in the year 2000. And I don't know, I just want to say there's a man sitting over there, Zubs, the last letter, who I studied religiously. There was an album called Listener's Digest.
Yeah.
Right? And that was an album that kind of, but that was a bit later when I was in Standard 6. So we studied Listener's Digest, the Book of Proverbs, Cut and Join. You know, when I say squadda, the rest shut the fuck up. I'm like, squadda, camp.
Camp, right?
Squadda, camp. Flip, flip, flip. You know?
They're too young.
Yeah.
It's okay.
You guys don't know what the fuck I'm talking about, right? So we studied all of that music. And, you know, when I figured out that it was something I could do, much like thousands of millions of young people around the world, it gave me an outlet to be like I could be a superhero.
Mm.
And that's the power of hip hop, and the power of being an MC is that you can turn into a superhero. And,
yeah.
And I fell in love with it.
You can create yourself, essentially.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So you're studying these albums, like the legendary albums.
Oh shit! I need to name more. There was this called Sprite Expressions.
I think it was called Expressions. From Outrageous Records.
Outrageous Records.
Yes.
Yeah. And there was shit, man. There was so much music that time. Man, there was shit. Like, do you remember that stupid song? It rocks. Ding, ding, ding. It rocks. Because I'm the bomb. Because I'm the bomb, like a suicide bomb. What? You know, but like I look back at it now, I'm like, man, that music really like. The music really formed me, because at that time, South African hip hop was really coming to the fore, you know?
Mm.
Like, that's when, like, Heads and Tails dropped. Wicked, Selvin, that's like, you know? So I come from a completely different era of South African hip hop music. I really did my, Do Me in the Volume.
Yeah.
Live at the Baseline, you know. So I really, Cashless Society, you know. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Yeah.
So all of that shit was like the stuff I was like taking in. And that became my like foundation for who I am today. Kind of.
So then in school, like, were you guys rapping the Zubs and Doomy and Proverb lyrics?
No, we
making up your own.
We, you know, much like any MC, man, these niggas ain't that good. Shit.
I can do that.
Yeah. You know, and that's the mind of an MC. I was like, let me tell you another story. One time we were performing at a social, so I went to a very Lani school. I went to St. John's, right?
Mm.
And we had this stupid group. I still cringe when I watch it to this day.
What's the stupid group? Give us context.
This group was called Entity. Right? And we were like kids, man. We were like young kids. And we had this stupid song called First Gear. Oh my God.
It had a dance move, right? Like it had choreography.
Oh, don't do this.
Come, let's do it. Let's do it. Let's do it. I know you remember it.
Please don't do this.
Shall we
go?
Okay. Cool. Tell the story. Tell the story.
And so fast forward in the first year of high school, we start a group. And anyway,
but
we come
before you get there, like, tell us how you get to the point where you start the group. Like, what's happening for you guys to think us three are the group?
Because you know, when you're that young, you think you know everything, and you think you're better than everyone. Like, we were straight tripping. Like, we were standing at six, thinking, man, I could take Zubs. I could take Tumi.
Yeah.
Like that, like we were that deluded, you know? And we ended up starting this group on a school trip. We went on one of these excursions, and, you know, we're on the bus, so all the white people are sitting in the front.
Yeah.
And, like, we at the back, you know? But we were like, just like beat, like, yo, don't underestimate the power of beatboxing, bro.
Yeah.
You know? You know, I'm talking about like real raw shit, no, like, you know? No, like, mics, no bedroom studios before all of that shit.
Yeah.
I'm talking about when you needed to actually know someone who actually has a studio, you know? And we started this group and we said, all right, cool, we're going to try to do this thing. But for me also at the time, I also just wanted to, you know, get some honeys, you know? Like, that was also a big part of it.
Yeah.
I wanted to go to the mall and, like, have people recognize me. Shit, man. I know I talk all over the place, but one of the things we used to do is like go to like the zone at Rosebank and see how many people could recognize us.
Is this like just after
the irony
touch and go?
The irony is today I want everyone to leave me alone. That's crazy, right?
Yeah. But so you were telling us the story about the social.
Oh yeah, the social. We performed, I don't know if you remember, so it was at St. Mary's. And we go into this room and the people, like the actual people performing there were like actual artists, Pro and Zubs.
Yeah.
And we go into some room and then do you remember?
Thank you, bro.
And we found them in some room, like they in the holding room, they was cool as shit and whatever. And now I'm fanning out and whatever. Ish. Anyway. And we found them in there and we were like, yo, we want to rap and this, that and the other. And I could see on their faces, they were like, psh.
They didn't raise you.
Y'all ain't never going to make this shit happen. But, you know, we had a good spirit and they were, you know, kind and they were really cool. And, you know, I just think at that time in the industry, the guys were in the industry, they had like a better energy than we have right now.
Yeah.
To the younger people. I'm still I'm a decent guy. But, you know, they were more like, you know, grounded and just more like, helpful and more inspiring, I think, back then than we are today.
Yeah. Where did the name Entity come from?
Who the fuck knows?
Really? You don't?
It's a terrible name. Okay. Also, by the way, AKA is the laziest, worst rap name of all time.
How did you come up with it then? Like,
so we needed to come up with a name. Okay. By second break, everybody's got to have a name in this group, eh?
Okay.
Second break. We all need a... Do you remember second break? Shit. By second break, everybody has to have a name. I'm sitting there like, what the fuck is my name going to be?
Mm.
So, what if I don't have a name? What if my name is every name? AKA. And you know, it's kind of weird because I grew into it, you know?
Yeah.
I always give the explanation about I do so many things and it kind of stuck, you know? I still want to change my name though.
To what?
You know, when I go to the States, they're like, your name is what? AKA? I'm like, shit, that's a whack rap name.
Yeah. You know, like, I don't think it's a whack rap name.
You know what I'm saying? Like, how lazy is that? That's terrible.
It's just hard to find on streaming services because there's so many AKA.
You know what I'm saying?
Things.
What a shit name to Google, right?
Yeah.
Well, you know, so, it's not so bad now.
Do you know what you want to change it to if you were going to change it?
Super Mega. You know what I'm saying? No, I did want to change my name to King Forbes, but also, shit, man. I'm the biggest Kanye West fan in the world. I'm a big fan of artists whose names are their actual names.
Yeah.
That would be dope to be like, Kanye West. Kanye West. Huh. Hmm. Michael Jackson. Hmm. Lionel Richie. Hmm. That's actually your name, isn't it? Yes, it is. You know?
Yeah.
So, but it's just my first name. It's so weird. The spelling is weird. And I don't want to spend my whole fucking life saying, no, it's not pronounced like this. It's pronounced like this.
Yeah.
It's too much energy. So I'll think I'll just stay as AKA.
Okay. So you guys were signed to Creative Kingdom.
What a disaster.
Who was Creative Kingdom? Who
absolute
owned it?
Absolute disaster.
And how did you get your parents to agree to, like, my son is in a rap group?
I mean, imagine. So my dad never... he never missed the opportunity to remind me how much my school fees cost, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he would always drill it into me. Can you imagine sending your kid to like a school like that? And then he's like, I want to be a musician. You know? Creative Kingdom. Creative Kingdom actually at the time... Okay, this is a very layered story. Do you guys know Malcolm X?
As in the South African Malcolm X?
Gangster. You know Malcolm X?
The South African one.
Yeah,
not the South African the actual Malcolm X.
Do you know Sipho Dlamini?
Yes.
Sipho Dlamini is now the head of Universal, right? At that time, they had Loyiso.
Bala.
Loyiso Bala, Leanne, who
Dlamini.
Became his wife, you know? And so that whole crew. And they had the sickest... office / studio in Sandton City, bro.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there by like where X-Trend is now. And you go up there in the offices.
Yeah.
You get in there. It was like a full proper studio with like a big mixing desk. It was the first time I ever seen such a big fucking desk in my life.
Yeah.
And we went and we did a gig in Orange Farm somehow. Which the sign apparently is like this.
When you're hailing
Snake
a taxi.
Park. Orange Farm. I always found that hilarious that this is the sign for Orange Farm. So we did a gig at Orange Farm. I call it a gig, but it wasn't actually a gig. It was just, you know, us trying to get on. I think we did it for, what was that thing they used to have? What happened to Love Life? Do you guys remember?
Yeah.
Love Life?
Mm. They had a TV show.
Prince,
and,
that yeah. Whole, I think it was Scoop on that shit. I think he was.
I don't know.
And we had a little gig there, and then Malcolm X found us. Anyway, crazy story. And then he said, okay, come. Yo, I'm from Creative Kingdom, this record label. Come, let's have a meeting. I want to sign you guys. On the way home. We're like, oh my God, we finna get signed. You know? And we had this meeting, and then we do this thing. And then, eventually... so they're like, all right, cool, we're going to make an album, what. But they were so smooth, they're so smart. They made us pay for it.
How?
Yeah. No, I'm sure, so we had to like go ask our parents for like dough.
Wow.
Yeah, we had to like, they finessed our parents out of like maybe 202 clips.
Damn.
Yeah, and but anyway, we did an album. It was dope. We didn't make a single cent.
Mm.
Nothing. I mean...
From first year?
Nothing. Yeah. Nothing.
Okay.
But you know what? They treated us well. You know, like, Sipho, he's a genuine guy. Malcolm, I look back on those days with, like, fond memories. Those were good people.
Mm.
But, you know, that was my first taste of, like, the recording industry.
Mm.
You know? So anyway, Creative Kingdom, and we released the album. Ha! The album was called Royal School of Hip Hop. How lame is that?
But is
That's
that where
so lame, dude.
Is that where the idea of being the prince of South African hip hop then comes from? Because you have this royal.
Yeah, I just couldn't call myself the king. So I had to call myself something, but I couldn't call myself the king yet.
Yeah.
That's why I said prince.
Mm. Yeah. So then you put out this album. You guys are in matric at the time, right?
No, I put out, You're out. We put out an album in Standard 7.
Oh, damn.
Mm.
That was soon. And then
2003. I dropped my first album in 2003. How crazy is that?
It's wild. So did you then have to like book off from school to go to the Kora Awards?
No. It was just on the weekend or whatever. I remember we met Missy Elliott.
Really?
Yeah, she was in a little wheel, so she had hurt her leg or whatever. It's crazy like thinking back about, I forgot better shit than you ever thought. You know, I forgot all of these stories and like, man, it was cool, man. It was really, really cool. It was a cool experience.
Mm.
But then, anyway, it ended.
Why?
because the other parents in the group of the other guys,
yeah,
they were like, what? You want to do what? No, you're going to be a lawyer. You're going to be an accountant. You know?
Yeah.
And I was the only one, thank God, my parents were like, all right, my boy, figure out what you want to do. Just come back to us with a plan.
Yeah. So you had got the Fruity Loops in Senate 7, you said, right?
Yeah.
And you were rapping with Entity at the time as well.
I wouldn't call it rapping.
Okay, you were putting words together. What would you call it?
Laming out.
Okay. So you were laming out with Entity.
Yeah.
And then...
You know, every time my birthday... So my birthday is now on the 28th.
Yeah.
MTV Base, every fucking birthday of mine, they play that stupid video. Yeah, first
But it's
gear.
Part of your legacy, man.
It's not.
I reckon
it,
you must just relearn the choreography, then perform it at your Bovamania shows.
Terrible, you know? Man. Cringy. Very cringy.
But so did you then continue to do the beats and then...
Yeah, I started making beats before I started rapping.
Yeah.
So I started making beats before I started rapping. And then, so one of my school friends at the time also, he wasn't part of Entity because his parents had some goddamn sense.
Yeah.
His name was Books.
Yes.
And we were school friends and we started Ivy League.
Where did that name come from?
Ivy League.
Yeah. Made Ivy
It was another lave name. instant vintage. Because we thought, like, man, we're going to make classic records.
Yeah.
So, like, as soon as we drop our shit, it's going to be vintage instantly. Instant vintage, Ivy League.
Yeah. So, you guys are these kids in high school, right? Mm-hmm. And at the time,
He had a show called The Essence.
Yes.
By the way, is one of the, like, best hip-hop shows we ever had. You know, obviously, all due respect to Will Speeds, died and
everyone
his
else.
Show and whatever. Yeah. But that, for me, was the show. It was on a Sunday night?
Mm.
I think it was on a Sunday night.
On 5FM, yeah.
On 5FM, The Essence. It was a dope show. And somehow I linked with him. And funny story, he's a KTV presenter. Imagine that shit.
Yes, he was a KTV presenter, but he was also a part of Ivy League, right?
He was.
How did you guys then end up making him? Because he wasn't making beats, right?
No, but we needed somebody to, like, plug us. But also, he had a good ear.
Mm.
You know, he might not have been making the beats. I mean, Books was making most of the beats.
Yeah.
You know, and I was making beats. But shame, my beats weren't as good as his.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So you guys would just slap on the name for everybody's beats.
Yeah, but it was a collaborative effort. And, you know, so Kamza, he plugged us in the industry. He was, like, working, you know, he was in the game.
Yeah.
And the first, our first big break was obviously when Linda, he came to us for beats.
Yeah.
And that's where the story now really kicks off.
Yeah. Do you remember how you met him?
Linda?
Yeah.
Shit, how did I meet him? Yeah, I met him in a studio session. And he was charismatic and, you know, he was like the smartest, coolest guy. I think he was probably wearing like a cool leather jacket or whatever, you know.
Yeah.
And I was like, in my mind, I'm like screaming like, oh my God, this is broken. Oh shit, you know.
Because I think he had a different recollection of how he met you.
He's a different guy. I don't remember the first time I met him. But
yeah.
How did he say he met me?
So he had an interview with Tediso. You guys know Tediso, right?
Tediso.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think, right, in your interview, he said he met you at Capello's.
Yeah. Ah, yes, he did. Funny story. He actually met me at Capello's. We were freestyling in the car, me and L-Tido.
Mm.
We're freestyling.
Yeah.
I wasn't as good as I am now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But anyway, you know, me and Tito were freestyling, whatever. And then it was the Capellas, I think, in Gandhi Square.
Okay.
Is that Capella still there? Yeah. Should I have been to Gandhi Square in a minute, dog? You know, and you're right. I might have met him at Capello's.
So
I think I might have actually met him at Muggs dropped a tape called Sorry for the Long Wait.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think that's where I met him for the first time.
So did he come and freestyle with you or is that
pro?
Where
he, yeah. No, what business did he have freestyling with me?
So at what point do you play him the bumper beat then?
Fast forward in the story, we end up, Kamza makes a link somehow. And the bumper beat came when he had signed with TS Records.
Okay.
So I think Kamza made a link somehow, and then they played him the beat. I wasn't there when they played him the beat. Obviously, Books made that beat.
Okay.
Right? And then before I knew it, I was in the session with him. Mm. Yeah, man, it was crazy. It was hectic. I don't want to get too emo-ish thinking about it.
We want you to get emo. So how do you then get kicked out of Ivy League?
Because I wanted to, because I wanted to do my own shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wanted to do my own shit. I found Teebs. So Teebs became my first manager, mm-hmm. right? And I was like, all right, I'm going to do this artist thing, aka I'm going to do it by myself. And the whole time, you know, they had obviously been supporting me, like, all right, we're going to do this thing together. Ish, but at some point I was like, man, I'm finna take it to the next level. I gotta find some of my new niggas to do this shit with, you know?
Yeah.
With Teebs, I need people with plugs, you know? I needed people with plugs and people who can put me into the industry and put me in the right places. So I was like, all right, boys, this is what I wanna do. They're like, all right, well, it's either them or us. I'm like, all right, well, fuck y'all then. I'm out.
Yeah.
But no, man, you know, those guys really held me down, Kamza and Books. Mm. And it's just cool, man. We just made a parting and I went on to go to, what's this company called? Fifth Season. Yeah.
Did you just say what's this company called?
Yeah, Fifth Season. And that was my first manager and then shit really started kicking off.
Yeah. So then you put out this mixtape.
Yes, 24/7/366. Another lame name.
Do you remember how the intro to that
don't give me credit. 24/7/366. That's something. I was talking rubbish, man.
Okay, I'm going to tell you what you said. Let me tell you what you said.
No, don't. Please, don't. No, please, I'm begging you, please.
The only reason I want to read it to you is because I think it's an interesting part, you know? Because you say, basically, what 24/7/366 means is we're putting that extra three quarters into everything we do.
Cringeworthy.
And then
so
you say, I did have a nice intro planned, but fuck it. Everybody is in the club, but we know, you know where I am. What was the original intro?
I don't even know if I... Do people still even do intros? I don't think I did. I was just like trying to sound cool probably and like... sound deeper than I really was. You know, I know we talk about a lot of this first stuff I did and I always be like, oh, it's cringeworthy and it sucks and whatever. But, you know, if you're an artist, if you're a true artist, well, as I feel, I hate my old shit.
Yeah.
Everything I make that I, like from before, I hate it. I don't want to listen to it. I don't want to talk about it. I don't want to hear about it.
Up until what point?
Like now.
Up until Touch My Blood.
If I have to perform Helen Versace one more time, I think I'm going to throw up, dude. Do you know what I mean?
Wow, okay. Well, in this section, we do have to talk about your past. I'll try to not make it as lengthy as it is, but I wanted to actually talk to you about your writing style then, because you spoke about how you felt like you wouldn't even call it rapping with Entity, right? And you still were making waves as a producer, as part of a production collective, but you decided to still go with Tibbs and with Fifth Season and rap. So how did you then change your writing style so that you could even listen to your music?
Back in the days, we used to have a book of rhymes. Uh-huh. Are there any MCs here? Any rappers here? Yeah? Did you guys ever have a book of rhymes? My book of rhymes. What happened to the book of rhymes, man? Ish. Niggas need to bring the book of rhymes back. You know, that big exam. that you know what I'm talking about with the red spine?
Yeah.
So when I was an Entity, like back in the day, I had my book of rhymes. Mm-hmm. You know? And then when I started, you know, when I became AKA, you know, whatever, you know, I stopped. If I could find that book of rhymes, I'd make a lot of money. But then I started... my car or whatever car I borrowed from my mom at the time or my dad at the time. What car did I have that time? I didn't have a car.
Wasn't it a Toyota Bucky?
Oh my God, I didn't have a car. Yeah, my mom had this Bucky. And I used to just like ride, like wake up in the morning, go drop her at work and then go mission for the day. So mission. And at the time, I just like have beats all the time. in the car, just listening to beats the whole day, beats after beats after beats after beats. And I would like write, you know, the verses.
Yeah.
And then maybe like, yeah, like rehearse them, not actually write them. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, yeah.
Like Jay-Z. No, well, not really. And that's how my writing style changed. And it became more about the beats. How can I get into the beat? And I had so much to say in that, like, you know where we are now?
Yeah.
This area, I used to have this, there's this place called College House.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's on Joris and, is it this side, no? College House, this way, no? I had this little, can you even call it an apartment? I don't even think you can. It's just like an open space, like so.
Yeah.
And I had a sleeper couch. I mean, my kitchen was in my bedroom, like that type of vibe, student apartment, you know? And I had a computer, you know, and that was what I did. I just listened to beats all day.
And you wrote. You just dedicated yourself.
Yeah. Okay. Did I answer your question?
Sort of.
I'm sorry if I digress.
But I have a more specific question now. Yeah. Because the second song on 24/7/366 is I Woke Up.
I woke up.
And in the pre-chorus, you say, and I'm not going to rap it like you, but maybe you'll remember. You say, man, life could be so beautiful, but we're trying to stay fresh to death till our funerals.
What a lame punchline.
That's interesting that you say that, because what I was going to ask you is it a companion piece to what you say on Bang? Do you remember what you say on Bang?
The only time I get to see my family is a funeral.
Yes.
No, I don't think it's a companion piece. I think at the time I was just trying to sound smart or whatever, you know? And for me, that tape, I think we dropped it on Christmas Day, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't even remember any of those songs. But now that you know, taking me back, you're actually making me a bit in my feels. Because that was a time I just wanted to get on. I was so just hungry, man.
Mm. Yeah. Okay, so well, Bang is a song on your debut album, Alter Ego. So just to reawaken everybody in the room, does everybody know Alter Ego? So on the count of three, I want you to shout out. Don't whisper it. Shout out. You can play too if you want.
Your favorite song.
Your favorite song.
Wait. Let me just...
But I'm going to count to three. I need to
Can you show me what songs are on an album quickly?
Are you being for real?
I'm being fucking for real. Okay. Like, I don't know the track list.
Okay. Let's
open. Let me see what's on that album.
Let's open.
What's on that album?
So what I was saying is...
Oh, yes. Okay, I know what's on that album.
Do you still need to see? Or?
Yeah, I'm ready. One, you ready to go?
So on the count of three, I need you to shout out your favorite song on Alter Ego.
Okay, let's go.
One, two, three.
I want it all. Yeah. I want it all.
Okay, so it seems like two songs.
High School Cool was a crazy joint.
So it seems like... two songs.
See, that's in that song where I say, we got the spirit, yes, we do.
Two songs really stand out, and I think we're going to talk about both of them, right? So, Bang, we already discussed, and you said it wasn't a companion piece to the previous song. But I Want It All, which is your favorite song.
That's one of my best songs I ever made. By the way, all of this, all due respect to niggas, this new age, new age quiet, or what, that is the first... Dude, that was the first time hip hop in Kwaito, but I would like to say that is where my sound actually started.
Yeah.
Because I've always had that 4/4 Kwaito hip hop sound. So that song for me is very important. Also because, in terms of sonics, but also because I was able to get on a song with Khuli motherfucking Chana and Pro Kid.
Yeah.
That was crazy for me. I remember writing those rhymes, and those are dope rhymes, by the way, thinking, oh my God, I can't let this dude murder me.
So you already knew that the two of them would be on the song when you were writing?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And did you know what you wanted it to be about? Like, how did you actually create the song?
I wanted it all. And I wanted all God's glory, God's pain and more. Yeah, it's all in the name I'm all. For the game I pause, what it takes to be great, my boy. Above anybody that came before, put the world on a wish list. So every day could be Christmas. The 25th is too far. Many fit girls in this club on a Saturday night who want to act like Christians tomorrow. That's very Kanye West-y, don't you think?
It is very Kanye West-y. Yeah. So my question then is, Pro has a legit verse on there, right?
Sure, yeah. Ivy League made, I believe, I be sick. Charge up 45 per gig.
Yeah.
45 today is like, huh? 45?
Oh, yeah?
That's trash.
So if I want to book AKA, how much?
If you're charging 45 today, like, you ain't really doing it.
How much are you charging today? Do I need to send through an email?
I don't want SARS up my ass.
Okay, so Pro has a verse on there, right?
Yeah, Pro has an absolute classic verse.
He does. But Khuli, like, absolutely shines on that chorus, right?
Yeah.
So much so that you would think that he had a verse on there.
One of the most legendary hooks of all time.
But then he appears on Bang with a verse.
Yeah.
So did he have one studio session where he did both, or did he have a verse before that you removed
No, he never had a verse. I always told myself, like, I gotta have two verses on the song. So that's what I made sure of, and he had a crazy hook.
Yeah.
But for Bang, he just came in, and you know who recorded my whole album, Alter Ego, was PH Raw X.
Yeah.
And Khuli came in, and shit, man, I was just so in awe of him. I still am in awe of him. Like, for me to, like, man, it still trips me out to be able to call these guys.
Yeah.
You know, that's how much of a fan of the culture I am. For me to be able to, like, call Khuli.
Yeah.
I always wanted to do that.
Yeah.
And now I can't. Yeah.
You also wanted to call him for the music video where he was going to be a hologram.
Oh, shit. Let me tell you this stupid story. So, you know, I wanted all, if you watch the video, there's scenes where we're like in front of a green screen. So we shot a video.
Yeah.
Dude, I kid you not. You must listen to the plot of this video. So I wanted all. Mm-hmm. He's going to be a hologram. And me and Books and Gamza, we're like in like SWAT gear. Oh my God, we're dressed in like SWAT gear and we're like finding like a treasure or something in the desert. So we found these guys who told us, oh man, y'all want to do that CGI shit? We could do that shit easy.
Not so easy.
Then we saw the video. We were like, oh my God, this cannot come out. We must destroy this immediately. And that's what we did. And so we made a plan. And then, because Teebs had a plug with Head Honcho. Ish, Head Honcho. That was another era. Shit, I've lived through the eras. Anyway, and then we did this. We said, all right, let's just take all the stock footage and put it together. And that's how we're going to make our video. And it worked somehow.
Yeah, we got another video. Hologram.
In that video, I am wearing the fakest Ray-Bans you've ever seen in your life. Yeah. That was back in the days where, like, everybody had a rooftop shot.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to shoot a video? All right, there's this rooftop in, man. That's what we did.
Yeah.
And I'm wearing these crazy fake Ray-Bans. Them joints were so light, man. Them joints was like a feather.
But
like,
at least you leveled up. And in the second section, we're going to talk about levels and that period of your life.
Second section?
Yes.
Do you got something to eat? I'm kind of hungry.
Zola? Oh, we're doing this right now.
Yeah, man. I do whatever the fuck I want. Okay,
Zola will handle. But if you've never been to Imbali Live before, we always do Imbali Live in three sections, right?
Right.
And in between each section, the audience gets to then ask a question.
Yeah, I can see their faces. They're like, when is this guy going to shut up? So ask him some questions.
So the point of that is because it is a communal experience. So if you have a question about the era that we've just discussed, so if you have any questions about Touch My Blood or whatever, don't ask it right now. We are getting to that point.
Oh, like come up era.
Stuff. Yes. So anything that you feel like, I've always wanted to know this, but you guys didn't mention it.
Can I say one thing?
Yes.
Can we give you a round of applause for this platform and for doing this?
Thank you. All right. Yeah. So
this is really dope.
Thank you. So I'm only going to take two questions in this section because I don't want you to be here till sunset. So there is a question over there with the afro.
My sister. I was like, oh, is that Boogie, my boy?
Oh, wow.
I'm joking. I kid.
So early on you said you don't like to talk about your old music and things that you've made in the past.
Say with your chest.
We can't hear you.
Yeah,
so what do you like to talk about?
What do I like to talk about?
Now that you don't like to talk about the music you've made and the past.
I like to talk about like funny, like weird stuff. Like I don't, the reason I don't like to talk about my old stuff is because I got better. I only want to talk about the shit, like my most recent stuff. You know, they say in sport, you're only as good as your last game. I don't want to talk about when I sucked, you know? In my mind, like alter ego was cool. Levels, yeah. Touch My Blood, that's my favorite album. You know, because I only want to talk about myself when I'm the best, like the latest, most iOS iPhone 11 version of myself. Yeah. I don't want to talk about, you know, the iPhone 6.
Once you've updated your iOS. Yeah.
Does that answer your question?
A question at the back. Sorry, Gabby.
I just want to know something. Hi, guys. My name is Zizwe. I just want to know something that, from your perspective,
yeah.
Now that it's 2020, I've been following up with your work for the last 10 years.
Nice. Thank you, brother.
I appreciate it, bro. And what I'd love to know is, from your perspective, for us underdogs and people who haven't blown up, what's the best way we can target the world the way Atlanta affected us via Noisy and everything? How can we have an upper hand as a country? Because you're the front man, you represent us, and I respect that. You're on the Drake status for me, so...
Can I interject over there? Because that sounds like a futuristic question.
Oh, okay.
So maybe, if you remember, just put your hand up at the end, and then maybe you can talk
answer,
about...
But let me, come on, let me answer the man's
okay,
question
sure.
at least.
Sure.
But naughty. What is your question? What actually is your question?
My question is,
like, what can you guys do?
What more can we do so that we can catch up with you? So even though we haven't been at your
level, let me answer you quick. Just be dope, simple and plain. Just make hot shit. I think I think people get so in their own heads, like, oh man, I gotta get the right drip. I gotta get the manager. I need no, bro. Simple. Just be good. Be really, really good. Be excellent. You know, excellence is the quickest way to, like, don't overthink it. Don't overthink it.
Yeah.
Don't overthink it. You know what you need? You know what everybody needs? One hot record. It always starts with one hot record. So, Victory Lap. I needed that one hot record. Khuli Chana, Talk Stick, one hot record. Pro Kid, Wazabona, one hot record. Do you know what I'm saying? So you need one hot record. That's all you need.
Okay, gotcha.
And then also just don't suck.
Cool, we're going to move into the second section now. If you have other questions, please save them. If we have time, I will come back to ask about his whole journey. But for now, we do have to move on.
To the next section?
Yes.
I am hungry though, yo.
Can you see that Zola's not here? She's sorting you out.
If you don't mind, maybe just like some Zimbas or something.
Some Go-Slows.
Yeah, some Zimbas.
Okay.
Some chips or something.
She's going to sort you out, don't worry about it. But around 2011 or 2012, right? So I think it was 2011 or 2012. But Kanye West came to Johannesburg to perform.
Barely.
And this beer brand who had brought him out had decided to give him this giant cube for him to come out of. This is the story, right?
And everybody
this is the
thought it was him. And then when I came out the cube, it was me.
So how did it end up being you?
Shit, man. I had a good manager at the time and found a good plug. Benza just did his thing and they got me to open for Kanye West. I still don't like those, you know, that terminology.
Yeah.
Oh, you open for Kanye West. It's so lame, you know, because... but at the time, it was like a dream of mine.
Mm.
But you know what? I didn't even get to meet the Khe. Imagine that.
Really?
Yeah, who even got to meet him? Did anyone meet him? I don't think anyone met him.
But you know, the reason
But we worked really, really hard on that show. I wish, you know, like... I just think at the time, I gave a good show that night.
Yeah.
And they made this cube. There was this big reveal, you know?
They didn't even announce who the act was going to be.
They didn't even announce it. It was me. And you know, the one thing that I regret, though, is that I didn't have enough hot, like really hot records. Or maybe I had like only like Victory Lap. I wanted all Jealousy. Jealousy? Shit, I forgot that. I forgot. I need to start performing that song again.
You do?
I really like that song. Jealousy and I think All I Know. That was about it. Like... That was all I had. But it was a cool experience. It was a really, really cool experience. It was my first time like performing on like a big stage. Like, you know, when you perform at the dome,
mm-hmm.
when you fill up the dome, like it was the first time me performing on like a massive stage.
Mm.
And like, I was like, you know, just, oh, my drip sucked that day, dude. I was wearing some t-shirt from Zara-ish. but it was cool. We rehearsed hard and, you know, we had a great, you know, we had a band. I think I even had dances.
I remember the cube. I remember seeing the cube.
And then my mom was there and before she was my baby mom, she was there too. You know, and it was cool, man. I was actually staying here in Newtown at the time.
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay.
I digress. I know I talk all over the place.
I know. We're going to piece it together.
Cool.
So I know you love South Africa. Like, I know that, right? Everybody knows that. We know you love Nigeria, particularly Lagos.
Well,
we know that.
Not as much as I love South Africa.
Yeah. But I'm curious about where Botswana ranks on your level of... people of places that you love, because it was the first place where you got to have a real conversation with this DJ called DJ Zinhle, right?
Yeah. Let me tell you the story. So we were booked at the same gig. But she slid in my DMs, right?
Oh?
Yeah. Yeah, that was like... And I'm talking about slid in my Twitter DM. That's how way back in the day this is.
Yeah.
Before the gram.
Mm.
Was it the gram?
No, it was definitely before.
Slid in my Twitter DMs. And man, I met this hun at a gig. And yeah.
What was in the DMs? Was this in Botswana?
She was talking some rubbish about like, oh, I want to do a song with you. I was like, psh, don't lie. You know? And then we got booked for this gig and I was so excited that she was booked for that gig because I was like, oh, yes. And you know, but she didn't let me hit it on the first day, though.
Yeah, okay, so we're going to skip that part. Right?
But I got her eventually.
So then, I think you guys have... all right, settle down. So you guys have been, like, pretty expressive about how you didn't want to make it a public relationship, right?
Are we going to talk relationship or are we going to talk music?
So a little bit of stuff.
I don't like talking about relationships.
But this is related to music, actually.
Yeah.
But shortly after that, you then put out this album that was still very rap, but also infused
levels.
Some house elements.
Oh, that was a big album.
It was a huge album. Yeah. But I'm curious about how much this house, this prolific house DJ being in your life
had
to do with that direction.
A lot. Look, colored people love house music. Do you know what I'm saying? And for me, that has always been part of my makeup as a as a musician and as a person, in that house music is always, do you remember that? In the beginning, there was Jack. You know, that type of vibe.
Yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. That shit was always, you know, that shit was always in me. Mm. And I always wanted to be like, I want to fuse this sound with like, I wanted to make the poppy, the most pop album I could ever make.
Yeah.
And that's what Levels was. Yeah.
But like, paint the picture a little bit for us. How does the idea come to you? Are you sitting somewhere and it just like, how does it happen?
I was just like, you know, people don't know this, but I hardly listen to hip hop music. If you drive with me around, I'm always listening to like, I actually listen to dance music a lot, you know, EDM, and that had always been my vibe. So yeah, you know, me being with her also, it was cool because I could also like, you know, house, man, ish. You don't know the name of the song. You don't know who made the song.
Yeah.
Like, I'd be like, babe, who made that song?
like, she was your Shazam.
I know that song. Yeah, these people made this song.
Yeah.
Tropical, what? Storm, what? No. So that also played a big... That did definitely play a part.
And
for me, I always wanted to... Every album must have a different sound. Like, my favorite example is Outkast. Every single fucking album sounds different.
Mm.
And that's how it must always be for me.
Yeah.
And I'm very proud of that album. I'm very proud of Levels.
Yeah. What was the house sample that you worked on first and was like, okay, this is a song?
Yeah, my way. I got the goose in the moon, no dash.
Yeah.
My way. It was on Soul Candy. Yeah. Soul Candy, whatever, 2-3. That's the other problem with house.
There's always volumes and volumes.
Is it on Fresh House 6 or 7 or which one, you know? But that was the first song of Levels that we worked on.
Okay.
My way. Yeah.
Dope. So
Jira.
Do you need
he
to
took
see-
all the publishing, by the way.
Do you need to see the track list once again?
Levels.
Yes.
No.
Okay,
no,
good. Levels. Because on the count of three, you're going to shout out
your favorite
song on Levels. Okay. One, two.
Run, Josie.
Three.
Run, Josie. Oh, Sim Dope. Oh, Sim Dope was on Levels, huh? That was a crazy song.
So tell us the story of Sim Dope then. Does he know that he's Sim Dope? Were you guys calling him Sim Dope?
Sim Dope is, do you guys know who Robert Kumete is? He's like a big baller. And I went to school with his son. We actually share a birthday, 28th of January, which is weird. Mm. We actually born 30 minutes apart.
Oh, wow.
Like literally 30 minutes apart. And... yeah, man, Sim Dope. That was our nickname for him. Dope is what we call him. And I just wanted to make a song. Oh, man, I had the sickest artwork for that song.
Yeah.
Do you remember I had like this, my school picture? That was really cool. I've had some fire artworks, by the way.
So did he come back to you and say, yo, man, are you saying I'm dumb, but I've got some dope clothes?
No, he didn't say that. He loved it, man. He really, really loved it because... that song was basically me telling a story of like, he was like mad amazing at sports at school. He was just like cool. You know, a lot of my songs are not that like deep.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was just, it's less about Sim Dope and more about me.
Yeah.
Actually, like the concept is like, man, I wish I had like a really rich dad.
Mm-hmm.
That's basically the premise of the song.
Yeah.
and for me, sonically, Tweezy worked. Oh, All Eyes on Me is on Levels, right? That was a big, big song.
I know. We're getting to it.
We're getting there. So Tweezy did Sim Dope. One of my favorite part about is that it's like the halftime breakdown.
Yeah.
Later on in the song. I thought the video was fire as well. Like, that was a really good song.
And it also has this
you think
line.
This is my best video? Better than Congratulate.
No.
You think better than congratulate?
No.
Congratulate was, I think congratulate is my best video. But Sim Dope is pretty heat as well.
Sim Dope also has this line, right, about how your daddy climbed up the ladder.
Daddy climbed up the ladder, but never ran out of steam. Yeah.
Until he ran out of steam. Yeah. I mean, because that changes everything if he never ran out of
steam. He did run out of steam, shame.
Yeah. and his reputation was damaged.
But never ran out of dreams. That's why I talk in my sleep. Fortunately, my esteem is awkward for people who awfully talkative in the street. Especially if all they're talking in the street.
Okay, so I wanted to talk about that sentiment in particular, about watching your dad grind and be this business person. And then him... She's not here. You see, they're coming.
Okay, sorry.
And then... for you to watch him and to watch him not succeed, how did that influence how you were dealing with
things? Thank you. Amazing. Zalasefe. I love you. Oh, I can't eat chocolate. It's like energy bar. Oh.
Why can't you eat chocolate?
What's happening to me? I'm starting to get fat. Anyway.
You can't eat chocolate because you're starting to get fat.
No, I can't eat sweets anymore. I'm about to turn 32. What business do I have eating sweets? Yes, you were saying?
So, watching your dad climb up the ladder and run out of steam, how did that impact how you were in your business?
Oh, it's coming through on the mic, no?
Is it coming through, Kito?
Okay, they're saying go ahead. My dad running out of steam?
Yes.
My dad was a big dreamer. Is still a big dreamer. So, my dad is from the flats, right? My dad is from Mitchell's Plain, Cape Town. And my dad, he was extraordinarily gifted. So he was like a maths guy, coding, computers, all sorts of shit. And this was like in the 80s, you know. And he always like had these crazy ideas about things he wanted to do. But, you know, my dad went to go work for Accenture and he started his own business, right? But my dad was a square, you know, in that, you know, business... In South Africa, my dad is the type of person, like if cops used to pull us over, he'd be like, yeah, what did I do wrong? Instead of saying malums, you know? my dad wouldn't like play the game. He didn't play the game. He didn't grease the homies for the tender.
He was straight-laced.
You know how business is in South Africa. You gotta, you know, grease the homie, like, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And he was like too square. So that kind of worked. And my dad also like was very, very short-tempered. Also, my dad hired like my entire family. Everybody had a job at his company. It was terrible, worst idea ever. And so he went through hard times and then he lost all of his dough, right?
Mm-hmm.
And for me, it was like, oh man, it would have been nice for his like dreams, to like all of his dreams and stuff to come true. But you know, true to form today, my dad's straight. He's living in Cape Town. He's remarried. You know, he's still making like apps and stuff. But, you know, he's like, he's still got ideas. He'll still call me like, my boy, I've got this idea about this app that I want to do. Imagine like, he'll be like, I know there's Uber Eats, but, you know, my dad wants to help people. He's like, you know, those aunties that like cook.
Yeah.
Like, you know, plates and stuff. It's like, what if there was an app like that? I'm like, yeah, Dad, there is. It's called Uber Eats. You know, but he's like still a dreamer and he still dreams and he's got all these cool ideas. So that line and that sentiment, it was about me like being like, oh man, Dad, you've also kind of like left me to like clean up your mess.
Mm.
And in essence, I had to become my dad.
Yeah.
Now I am actually my dad. I take care of my whole family now. I would have liked to have a situation like, oh, this is your house that I'm leaving you.
Yeah.
Oh, this is your trust fund. That would have been nice.
But you had to grow up a little bit.
But my dad gave me the most important thing, which is the gift of music.
Yeah.
So I guess the old man didn't do so bad.
Yeah. Another interesting thing on levels is... The first voice we hear on levels is not your own.
It's Doomies.
The first voice
what
we hear...
What an intro that was.
The first voice we hear on Return of the King...
Is we did like a little swap.
Yes.
Yeah.
Tell us how that then happens?
Shit, man. I just was pushing my luck. See, man, if do you think Doomy could do an intro for me? And yeah, he did. You know, Doomy really fucks with me, bro.
Yeah.
And it's a source of pride for me. Like, Stogie, my bad. Stogie is what we call him now. And he really came forth and he made this cool intro. And also that the music on that intro is so sick. Levels, doop, boop, boop, doop. That's how it goes, eh?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it was sick. I loved it. Yeah.
So you had the plan from the start that
from
he
the start,
would...
I want Doomy to do an intro for me.
But you
and
all...
then when he did his album, he actually, I think he hit me and was like, yo, you know what we should do? You owe me one. You should do.
Yeah.
Oh, shit, I even forgot. I've got an intro on one of Doomy's albums. That's dope.
Yeah.
That's dope.
Well, he's a frequent collaborator of yours, but
yeah.
Somebody else who's collaborated with you and you guys had a huge song together is KO.
Mm-hmm.
And on IG stories this week, you were rapping along to his part. You were a little bit drunk?
I was a bit lit.
Okay.
Off the watermelon.
So the first time you hear his verse on Run Josie, what goes through your mind?
I'm in deep shit.
Oh, yeah? You hadn't written your verse
yet? He totally rinsed me, man. You win some, you lose some.
Had you already written your verses and roped them in? Like, how did that happen?
I already wrote them. I couldn't rewrite. He just came in. How does that verse go? How does this verse start?
My flow is so hazardous.
My flow is so hazardous. Fun like it's can nobody. Competition. No challenges. Tuna. Going. You know? For me, to work with him, he to this day is he's like on the Mount Rushmore of South African hip hop. He is a hero. He is like I feel blessed that I was able to work with him. Man, I've worked with like the best of the best, and I don't take any of them for granted, man. You know, in my opinion, Skanda Republic is probably the best South African, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Sorry, Zabs, in my opinion, is the best South African hip-hop album of all time.
Damn.
Wouldn't you guys think so? I think Skanda Republic is probably the best South African hip-hop
album ever
made. Well, everybody has their own opinion. Listen.
Maybe we should pitch the idea to MTV
and
do that.
Either Motsoko Originator or Skanda Republic. It also depends on what era. Some people also say like Mafoko Wame. Some people will say Touch My Blood.
So then you've said All Eyes On Me was the last song you recorded on the album.
Yes.
Was it the last because you almost didn't put it on, or?
It was the last song because, you know, all the clubby songs, like the clubby vibey songs, are always done last. So like Felon Versace is like is probably the last song I made on Touch My Blood.
Mm-hmm.
And All Eyes On Me is the last song I made on Levels, because when I make an album, I want to do the what I call the album music first, like take out of here and make what's saying the right way, and make all that type of music first, and then at the end I'll make the jiggy stuff, because the jiggy stuff is easy. I mean, what do I have to talk about?
Yeah.
Nothing, basically.
Does it
like a fish and chips from the north, southwest, and east. I mean, fuck, you know?
And then does it feel like a full stop? Like, do you make the club song and go, we're done? Like, do you know immediately? Like,
I know when it's... Are you asking when do I know when an album is done?
Yeah, because if that's the last song...
I have to count how many radio songs do I have. So I make all the proper music,
mm-hmm.
Which album are we talking about? Levels.
Levels.
You got to make all the deep stuff. I call it the deep stuff because
mm-hmm.
it means something.
Okay.
All Eyes On Me. It has no substance to it whatsoever.
Mm-hmm.
So then I count how many radio songs I have so that people can go listen to the actual album. So be like, oh, some dope, which is actually pretty deep. Maybe I'll be like, okay, All Eyes On Me. Okay, we've got about four singles. Cool. The album is done.
Okay.
Because my theory has always been, people don't want to listen to fucking sad music, dude.
Yeah.
Like, people want to feel better. Your job as a musician is to make people feel better about themselves.
Mm.
That's what so many artists, like, don't get. Nobody wants to hear about your problems.
Mm.
People want to dance. People want to sing. They want to laugh. They want to have a good time.
Yeah.
And all that, like, deep shit, they'll catch it on the album.
Yeah. So, with All Eyes on Me, I think everybody's got either a verse that they like or a part that they like of the song, right?
And All Eyes on Me?
Yes. Mm. And
my favorite is JR's verse.
Yeah?
He was also talking rubbish.
About what?
About everything and anything.
You mean on the verse?
All of us spoke rubbish. The
you
whole
did. You and it was a fun video. But it also became a huge continental smash.
It
got played like in parts of Europe as well, right?
Yes. And States, everywhere.
Yeah. And you also had Burna Boy on there, right? Mm-hmm. Which you have had on Baddest. Mm-hmm. And you've also had on that Sarkodie song.
Imagine now he's tuning me. Imagine that.
So my question then is, because he's somebody you've frequently collaborated with and you've uh-huh. made huge songs together, what is the difficulty between, like, let's just sit down and have a conversation between you and Burna Boy?
I just think that, first and foremost, I just want to say that I love Burna Boy's music. Mm-hmm. I love Burna Boy as a person. He's between him and Bongani Fassie, those are the two most genuinely talented people I ever met in my entire life.
Mm-hmm.
You know? my whole chop was just, like, don't shit on my country, dude.
Yeah.
How bad is that? Is that really such a bad thing to stand up? Like, also, you know, misinformation. Those guys, people said, you know, our people are dying. They're being slaughtered. You guys are talking shit, man. Nobody was killed. No Nigerians did. More South Africans died here than Nigerians. What the fuck are y'all talking about? Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So if you're gonna, if especially him also, because he's such a big artist and he has such a big voice, like, don't spread misinformation, especially about my country.
Okay. So I'm going to borrow a line from Simdo.
Oh, your question was, what does it take for us to talk?
Yes.
We did talk.
Oh, yeah?
During that whole thing. We talked, we messaged, but, you know, look, I don't wish the man any ill or anything. I actually love the guy. There was a time when Nigeria hated Burna Boy. Do you know that?
Mm-mm. Why did they hate him?
He was like AKA of 2011. But in Nigeria. You know, and we I wouldn't say we took him in, but, you know, that man ate Leslie's mom's fucking food, dude. Like, he is our brother. So time heals all wounds. It's okay. I'm not stressing. Also, to tell the truth, I grew up, Burna Boy is a young man. I'm not going to call him a lighty, but in our terms, he's a lighty.
He's younger than you.
He's younger than me.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a dad. I'm somebody's father. You know, understand?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, but, you know, sometimes your little brother, I don't care if he's got more dough, he's bigger, whatever. He's still, to me, he's my little brother. Don't ever forget that.
Okay. I'm going to take a little break to say, guys, this is going to be available on youtube.com/Helen Herimbi. So please stop recording loads and loads of videos of it. That'll
please,
be
guys.
Great. Mm. Thanks. But what I
want to reiterate, like, I really do love the guy.
I know. So
it's a shame. It's a bit unfortunate.
Oh, well. Anyway, so I want to take a line from Simdope about making peace with your enemies. Your conscience is clean.
Oh, you're going to go there now?
We have to go there, you know, because...
You're going to talk about the guy.
He's coming also. But before there was the guy, there was also other guys.
Other beef. Oh, L-Tido and that.
So you had...
That was a fun beef, yeah.
You had Come See Me for Dalez. I mean, for Black Les, not Dalez. For Black
Les.
And you also had an issue with L-Tido.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. In hindsight, do you feel like those beefs were unnecessary?
They were totally necessary.
Isn't that
the essence of hip-hop?
Why were they necessary?
Because we're battling. Mm-hmm. That's the essence of hip-hop, is to battle, is to test your skill against other artists. Mm-hmm. Not even artists, MCs, rappers.
Yeah.
Beef and hip-hop, you can't separate them. They're synonymous.
Yeah.
What would hip-hop be without beef, guys?
Yeah. I don't remember how the L-Tido thing started. Do you remember?
Yeah, I do remember.
Do you want to tell us about it?
So, actually, I was sitting... Oh, funny story. Rest his soul, Chili M, mm-hmm. who just passed. They had this song called "I'm on a Kush, I'm on a Hit, I wanna get my swag right." You know that I'm a red. I was just listening to this. I was like, "What the fuck is this whack shit?" You know. And then I was also a bit like aggressive and like, man, I need to get noticed somehow. So I think I went on Facebook, and then and I think I said, "Man, this is some real whack shit." Whatever, thinking like, "Oh, nobody even knows who I am," but. Let's see where this gets me. And those guys took the bait.
Mm-hmm.
They took the bait and then they found me and they called me and they threatened me and all types of shit.
Like on the phone?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And then they kind of dispatched. It's so crazy now that me and Lee and Les are so close because that was his song.
Yeah.
And then Tito was kind of the one dispatched to like start, like, okay, go handle this young boy.
He was dispatched.
Yeah, he was dispatched. But it was kind of funny because at the time they had this thing called the Glitz Gang. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah, that's super lame names. Ferrari Tito, McLaren Mo. Oh, Morel had a dope song. Do you remember that song? "I'm riding with my homeboys, loving all the brownies and the yellow bones." Yeah.
Wow.
He had this terrible line on that song. He said, something about like a sandwich, like cheese, boy. And anyway, so they had, and then Mugs and everyone, and Bongs. And then, so I think that's where the genesis of the beef started.
Yeah.
And that was, do you actually know that beef actually, if it wasn't for that, you know, we actually created V Entertainment.
I remember.
If it wasn't for that beef, V Entertainment probably wouldn't even exist.
I think there's a story about how Vuzu was named out. I mean, Deleuze named Vuzu.
Yeah, they had like a focus group. And Leslie actually came up with the name for Vuzu.
Yeah, he gave it that name. Okay, so but at least you made peace with your...
Is that the Tito question, beef questions?
Yes.
Anything else about that beef you want to know?
About that specific beef?
Yeah.
No, but I want to know about another... Did you want to tell me about the L-Tido?
No, I mean, I think that beef deserves its own like section in this discussion.
Sure. Is there something else you wanted to say about it?
What do you want to talk about? There's tons of shit that happened in that beef.
Yeah? What's the thing that stands out for you the most?
They fucked my mom's car up.
No way. The Toyota Baki.
Oh, they fucked that car up like crazy. I was coming. There was this... So, me and Teebs, because Teebs was cool with him as well.
Mm-hmm.
So we had this thing. We were like, all right, we're going to do a beef. We're going to do a beef show.
Yeah.
There's this club thereby. It used to be there on William Nicol before Monty. Saint-Tropez.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And then we're like, all right, we're going to throw this beef gig, do the flyer. But, you know, it was also kind of a bit like, it was a bit snarks because we didn't invite Tito, but we put him on the flyer. And then we were like, all right, cool, we're going to have this beef gig and I was going to go perform the song.
Yeah.
Shit, which song? Ah, I forgot. Anyway. And we got there and Tito didn't show. And then Vuzu was there. Yes, Vuzu was so gassed. Yeah, they were like, oh my God, this is amazing. And I was also super gassed. And I was like trying to be a tough guy and shit. And then I was like, yeah, L-Tido, I guess we know what the L stands for. And I performed the shit, and the shit was amazing. And then now I'm driving out. Actually, I even has picked up a nice hand. I'm dipping out now softly. And then, like, now I'm like getting the props. I want the props from everyone. Like, yo, you killed it, baby. Yeah, yeah. So now I'm gassed up. Now I'm driving out. Some guy is like, yo. Like, I'm thinking I'm gonna get some props. Like, yeah, baby, what's happening? Then it started. Boom. shying me through the window. I'm like, oh my God, this is real beef. Niggas come out, jump on my mom, on the bonnet of the car, like fucked up the car, everything. It was fun though.
It was fun?
No, I'm just like, it was fun, man. I don't believe that, you know, niggas have like issues these days and beefs. It's not beef until somebody catches a washer. You have to catch a washer. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
What beef is this today that these niggas is doing?
Yeah.
Like, I love Flame and I love Aries. But what the fuck are y'all doing shouting at each other? Somebody throw.
Okay.
Do you know what I mean?
Views of AKA are the views of AKA. They do not represent imbali life. Thank you.
I'm just saying, that's the way I grew up. I went to a boys' school.
Yeah.
You have a problem with somebody, you don't talk. You just see them and you just rock them.
For sure.
Yeah. And that was like, oh shit. And then Sean Page has also kicked my ass.
Mm.
Yeah.
So you've caught quite a few.
So then I'm at the SABC downstairs. We're in the corridors and, you know, I'm running my mouth crazy. Lo and behold, I come out of one of the corners of the rooms. Guess who's in the corridor just with me? L-Tido and Sean Pages. But you know me, can't back down.
Yeah.
So my mouth starts going off. Man, Sean Pages, he just turned his cap backwards. Just hit me right here. If you guys go look, there's my first at the Hype Awards.
Yeah.
I've got a big pink mark on my forehead. Man, that boy can throw down.
Over some amaretto.
Over some armor fucking red. Imagine that. Yeah.
So, you know, Khuli Chana was our guest last year here on Imbali Live. Did you watch it? Okay. So, this is what he said, right? He said, when Kaz was just starting to blow up, the guy who put me onto Kaz's music...
It was me.
...was Kiernan.
Oh.
He said, you need to hear this dude. He's from your hometown.
People always snipe me in the end, you know?
So how did you discover his music and
Casper.
Then... Yeah.
Shit, man. I think there was this thing called the Hot 9 at 9. YFM used to have this thing called the Hot 9 at 9.
Yeah.
I used to... Yeah, right? And every morning when it used to come on, I used to be like, oh, what number am I today? Shit, album number one, you know? Like back in those days. And I think I heard his music on there and I also heard his music on Hype. You know, ish, man.
When
we need that shit
CDs.
To come back, dog.
Yeah.
Hype tape. Do you remember that shit?
Yeah.
Don't you think we need that shit to come back? Or is that shit still there?
No.
It's gone. Shame. Ish. Man, we need that shit. Anyway, so I heard this shit on there and I thought it was cool, man. And shit, what was my first joint that I really liked? He had a song called Wrong or something like that.
Okay.
And I was like, oh, this is not bad. Yeah, that's.
And then you reached out to him to like make songs with him?
Just like Biggie and Pac, we was friends, man. You
yeah.
know? He even came to my crib. I even made like Sunday lunch for the dude.
Oh yeah?
Yeah. The problem is that me and him are the exact same person. That's the actual problem.
In what way?
There's no room for both of us.
Okay.
It's one or the other. One must die.
So when did you start seeing that you actually couldn't be friends with him anymore? What happened for you to decide
what
you're
done? What actually fucking happened? Oh, Twitter. I think that, you know, competition and when you're in the same space, it brews that kind of, you know, hip-hop, it kind of brews that. And eventually it's like, man, there ain't enough space for both of us. So I think we just, at some point, somebody just has to strike. But also, you know how it is, people talk about people talk behind your back. Maybe I said shit about him to my friends. He said shit to his boys. And maybe those people are both our boys. Or, you know how these things start, man. But ultimately, it was really about, like, yo, we finna be the dogs.
Yeah.
And, like, there's not enough space for both of us. That's, I just think, how it started.
Yeah. Okay.
I don't think there's even a reason. I don't even know why we started beefing.
Yeah.
But thank God we did. I say thank God we did because that beef really blew us up.
Yeah.
Till this day,
mm-hmm.
people still like You know, people, all that shit about like, oh man, we need to see unity. That's bullshit. You guys love the drama too much. And we feed into it and we... And now there's definitely a genuine dislike for each other now.
Yeah.
Like, we really don't like each other.
Yeah.
But I will say, I'm sure that there is definitely a genuine mutual respect for each other.
Mm.
But he definitely knows I'm a better artist than him. Definitely.
Okay. So you know who I thought you had
Definitely a better artist.
You know who I thought you had a genuine connection with? Anati.
Mm.
You guys put out the saga together.
Mm-hmm.
And then you
know I'm the one who got Anati to rap in Xhosa.
How?
What I'm the one who said, dude, why are you rapping in English? Start rapping your language. And do you know that Yanga actually wrote...
Oh, yeah?
Yanga wrote that. Because I called Yanga and I was like, yo, please can you activate this man's juice? And you know what? That time I spent with Anati, he really embraced it. And can you hear the artist he is today?
Yeah.
You know, and Anati is another one of my little bros. I've got the most ultimate respect for Anati. Ha! But me and also Anati, we also didn't like each other at some point.
I know. Because you said you hated the Saga video. Is that why?
I hated it, yeah. No, we didn't. I don't think a beef started because of that. What? Did I say something about Saga on the
You beat? Said you hate it.
Now you want to charge me 30,000 for a beat. I remember that.
And that's a discount because you said 80,000.
80,000. It was 80,000 for a beat.
Because, okay, so maybe let me refresh your memory.
I was just a shit person, man, a couple of years ago. Not a shit person. I was maybe a bit like too like short with people.
Yeah.
And when I had my daughter... And I like matured and like mellowed out. And Anati, man, he's a brilliant, brilliant artist, man. And it was so cool working with him. And the composure, Anati originally made the composure beat.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was like, all right, cool. Can I have this beat? He's like, yo, that's going to run you by 80,000. I'm like, nigga, what? And then I'm such an asshole. I went and remade the beat.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so that beat that you're hearing today, the composure beat, is a remake of a 90s original beat.
Damn.
Yeah.
Did you...
I was like, nah, pa. I'm gonna just go remake this beat. What you gonna do about it? What you gonna do?
Okay.
Know what I'm talking about?
So, did you listen to his debut album?
What was his debut album called?
The one that had so many rooms.
Yeah. Artifact. Oh, yeah. I did listen
to it. So I think it's on the end of So Many Rooms or on one of the songs at the end. He does that. Dum, 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 dum.
For real.
So that part was his and you took that part?
Yeah.
So you took that part?
No, I went to PH Raw. PH Raw X actually remade the entire beat.
Oh, wow. That's not cool.
You got to do what you got to do sometime. I ain't got no 80 racks on me. Fuck out of here. Trying to show me 80,000 rand for a fucking beat. You crazy.
Okay, so...
But once again, Anati, absolute brilliant, brilliant, brilliant artist. I learned so much from him. Just his energy. You know, Anati's like a very zenned out, like, young man.
Yeah.
Smokes a lot of weed, yeah.
How? Okay, he is very zenned out. A little more zenned out than you were in 2015 because you, I think in 2015, you were about 2,000 CDs away from reaching gold for levels.
Mm-hmm.
When you were like, how come
I funny
went
is the
gold
most
in a day?
Artist of all time, dog. He is totally rubbish, dude. So in terms of like, I don't want to knock up another man's hustle, but guys, I mean, come on.
Okay.
He's rubbish. Yo.
So do you guys know this story with Ifani?
He was like, what did he send me? He sent me some golden handshake.
He did send you a
like,
golden
that's
handshake.
That's cap, man. That's cap. But in hindsight, I was being an asshole. I shouldn't have done that because I was knocking another man's hustle.
So here's the thing, right?
I shouldn't have done that. But what you going to do?
For people who don't know, what you alleged was that this cider actually bought 20,000 copies.
But he was a rubbish artist, yo.
Okay, but let me tell the story then.
And I say was because he's totally dead right now.
Okay, so you were saying that this company had bought 20,000.
He's done, dude. He's done.
Am okay, I lying? Wait.
Am I lying, bro? He's done, dog. He's done. If you make yourself an enemy of mine, I'll kick you for the rest of your life, my brother.
Okay, so how did you know that this brand had bought the 20,000?
How could he try and have smoke with me? Is he out of his goddamn mind? Sorry, yeah?
How did you know that this brand had bought 20,000 copies of his album?
Because I did my research.
Okay. So it's something you had, like...
It was just a different... I was a different type of person back then, man. I was a piece of shit in many ways.
Okay.
You know, and I used to, like, spend a lot of time trying to, like, shit I shouldn't have spent time on, you know? And maybe I felt a bit hard done by because my shit was so amazing and so dope and I'm so good. And then this guy is gold? That doesn't make sense.
I mean, he did send you a golden handshake, right?
Yeah.
He did send you a
you
picture.
You see, like, what kind of beef is that? Like, what was that?
I don't know, but people found it funny and you found it funny that he would send you. Right. And this is what I want to ask you about because you've had, like, some crazy ups and downs play out in public, right?
Mm-hmm.
And one of the moments that people found a little bit funny, right, that had to do with you, uh-huh, was when our girl B, uh-huh, went and said she needs an apology from DJ Zinhle, mm-hmm, by 5 p.m., right? Uh-huh. I don't know if you remember the story.
Mm-hmm.
And then DJ Zinhle went and said, let's create a playlist of all the apology songs.
She did that?
Do you guys remember this?
Yes.
It was fun, and it was funny.
I don't think I remember that because at the time I was going through the most, my life was in pieces.
Yeah, so this is
so
what I wanted.
It might have been funny for y'all.
Yeah.
But it wasn't funny for me.
So this is what I
wanted
to...
Kicked, I actually got kicked out of our house.
Mm-hmm.
Went to go stay with Leslie for 3 months.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this is what I wanted to ask you. Like, so for the public, because it's not us, that stuff is funny. Like, oh, let's create a playlist. But for you, do you look back at that period of your life and is there anything that makes you chuckle?
No.
So you were just flames.
In terms of that whole thing? No, not a damn thing was funny.
Yeah, it was flames the entire time.
Not flames. Life.
Yeah.
It was shit, man. It was shit.
Yeah.
Let me ask you guys a question. You guys are guys, right? There's guys in this room. I'm not the first person to cheat. You know what I mean? There's hella cheaters in this room right now.
Guys
but
and
the
girls.
Thing is, but the thing is, for me, everything is magnified and I'm not going to complain about it, you know, because I did do wrong. And I did do wrong. I really did do wrong. But there's no anonymity,
mm-hmm,
for me. And I'm not complaining about it. It's just that, you know, it's still sore for me.
Yeah.
It was sore. And even to this day, for Zinhle, like, and for Bonang, they didn't find it funny either.
Yeah.
It's not fun to go through that shit.
Yeah. I hear you.
And for my mom, you know, wasn't fun at all.
Yeah. So before we go into the next, I'm going to take two questions for the next phase. So you're in Los Angeles at some point, right?
When, Helen, are you really going to do this to me?
What did I do?
Are you going to ask these questions?
What?
Anyway, carry
on. What's happening?
Where's
you don't
tea?
Like the questions.
Tea. Yeah, carry on.
Yeah, so what I want to know is, you were at the M2 or M1 studios there at SABC when you ran into Sean Pages and L-Tido, right?
Correct.
You're in Los Angeles,
mm-hmm,
at some hotel lobby, uh-huh, when you run into Anati.
We ran into each other. We had been beefing for like a year. I'd stolen his beat. And we just bumped into each other. And you know what? I kid you not. I just didn't have that thing in my heart, that qual anymore.
Yeah.
We were just like, yo, later. Like,
you wanna
make some music? All right. Let's just make some music. And I'm sorry, bro. Yeah, I'm sorry too. Sorry for charging you $80,000 for a beat. And then we just like, and from there, we went on and we made an entire album together.
I know.
What a beautiful story, don't you think?
A Summer nominated album. Dope. So we're going to talk in the next section about, well, we've spoken about that particular album, but we're going to talk about Touch My Blood and wrap up. So if you have any questions about the Levels era, I'm going to take this question over here and that young lady over there.
Oh, come on. Don't only take two, man.
But we're going to have time at the end. No, that's why.
Ask the question. But like, come on.
This is why I asked you, do you know how this thing works? At the end, then more people can ask. But for now, so we can move on to the next thing, you know?
Okay. Yeah. It's your show.
What's up, AK, man? I just wanted to ask, like, throughout your career, at which stage did you feel that, okay, you're starting to make money from music, and where at least you can make a living out of it? Which stage was there where you're like, okay, yeah, I'm getting something now?
Well, it's all relative with regards to what is a living. For some people, 10 blocks is a living. For some people, 100K is a living, you know, so or 200 or a million, or whatever the case may be. So it's first and foremost, it depends on what you want out of your life as a living, right? So my main goal at the start of my career was to have money for gas, right? Petrol. That's all I wanted. Petrol and cigarettes. You know what I'm saying? And Hunter's Dry or whatever the case may be. And it progressed to the point where the first big check, well, to me it was a big check.
Yeah.
Was when I got 5,000 rand. I was like, oh, I'm rich. Now I'm rich.
Yeah.
We did a gig at Roxy's in Melville, and I got 5,000 rand. And we had a crazy night that night. Oh, shit, I went. I didn't even have a car, you know. And for me, when I really felt, okay, I'm starting to make a living, was when I bought my first car. You know, I had a little Nissan. Probably when I started charging about 20 for a show, 10. Yeah, I was like, okay, cool. I can make a living out of this. But shit, man, if I had that money today, I'd kill myself. Yeah.
Wow.
You know? But now I feel like I want more. You know, so it never really, it's not really about, so it's really about where are you in your life, you know? Yeah. But to each his own, you know?
Yeah.
How much the question is basically, how much money is enough money? You know what I'm saying? It's not enough money, my brother.
Yeah. We're going to take one more question from Mickey.
One more.
For this section.
Okay, so I... Hi.
Hello. Hello. What's up?
Good. You spoke about beefing being in the essence of hip-hop,
correct,
right? And you speak a lot on social media about how you believe that the females are, like, you know, are playing too easy.
Come on, let's fucking get it.
But do you not think hip-hop also needs to evolve with the time and the nature of energies and just what's happening in, you know, in the current world, you know? Do you think that there still remains a place for beef in hip-hop in 2020?
As long as people pay attention to drama and beef and scandal, there will always be a place for it. Imagine we had like a dude. Let me tell you something. The girls, there's so many amazing female artists. Yo, Helen is always like very touchy. What's the correct terminology?
Oh, what?
You can't say female MC, ne? Or what?
You know, no,
MC.
You can't. They just are say women
MC.
Rap.
MCs.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, I think that we need a nice lit, you know, beef. From the hands.
Yeah.
We need it. Imagine like Rouge and Nadia can like have a proper beef. Wouldn't y'all listen to them records?
Would y'all listen to them records?
You would, right? They would be on every TV station. They would be on the news you know what I'm saying? They'd be on the news. I'm just saying them two, for example. They would be on every single episode of the entertainment. Twitter would be lit. Instagram. So it would ultimately, I'm not saying let's encourage bad energies and beef. Maybe I'm saying like, yo, let's battle.
Mm-hmm.
Come on, let's battle. Let's go for it. Otherwise, it's crash.
Yeah.
And one thing hip hop is not is crash, bro. You feel me?
Okay. Yeah.
Also, by the way, Also, like, D-Koala is pretty lit, right?
Yep.
Totally.
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
Who said that? Yes, sir. I think Rouge is the best rapper, though. By far.
Best rapper, period?
She could eat a lot of the dudes.
Yep.
Definitely.
Yep.
Not me, though. Oh, we actually have a record coming out. Me and Rouge. Yeah.
You recorded it already?
It's done. It's coming out like now.
Oh, dope. Okay, so we're going to talk about Touch My Blood, and then we'll open up for a little bit more.
What do you guys think of Boise? She's dope. But here's my thing, right? Listen. No, listen.
Okay, let's hear you out.
I'm not... Her delivery, her flow is out of this world, right? But there's always going to be that question, did you write your shit?
Can I just say something about that?
I'm not saying she doesn't write her shit.
She doesn't. But let me say something about that.
What do you think about that? Because when I'm in a studio session and people help me too.
Okay.
So, you know, there's a fine line. Do you think Kanye West is writing all of his shit? No. Yeah. Even Drake doesn't even write shit.
Yeah. Here's the thing, though, right?
Drake does write his shit.
And she also addresses...
So, you know, where's the line? You know?
The AKA show, ladies and gentlemen.
Sorry, guys.
So she also addresses that, like, I mean, I think her line is something about now you want to have a conversation about the lyrics. When she first came out, she said, Nasty C, right?
Writes my shit.
Yes.
Yo, it's hectic.
I mean, she did say, you know, he
but
helped her.
How can
her.
You do that as, a, that he as helped an MC? Her.
But the thing is...
What type of MC says, this guy wrote my shit? What type of MC is that?
Okay.
Don't you think?
So, now I want to...
However, that Tatako remix verse...
Fire, right?
Out of this world.
And the thing is, she'll learn and she'll get better and she'll write her own stuff by herself and she'll be fine. But I want to talk about when you said sometimes people help you as well. Because with Touch My Blood, you I think the back of the album says it was produced or executive produced by you and the homies.
Yeah.
Who are the homies and what role did they play in...
Just the boys, like your friends. I don't know how many, like, MCs we have here, but when you're in a session, like, you come up with shit, like, say, no, don't say, rather say, oh, don't, do you think I should say, no, say, you know, so,
yeah,
it's more like that. I believe I make music for, is that my refill? Is that for Helen? Thank you very much, sis, appreciate it. Zola 7.
Thank you, Zola. Sola. Thank you.
So, yeah, the homies, man. It's just the boys who are always hanging around. Jabu, Don. Anybody can be one of the homies.
Okay.
Because the point that I'm trying to make, executive producer, AKA and the homies is like, it's like me saying like, yo, lots of people helped me with this album. There were so many people in studio sessions. Honeys in the session. Like, everybody has something to give.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I recorded that in so many different places. There's even you know that song?
Yeah.
There's even a part where there's a honey says, you see that? I don't know, like
she's a homie as well.
So anybody can be part of the energy at any time.
Okay, I feel you. I hear you. So, on the count of three.
Touch My Blood.
Yes. Your favorite song on Touch My Blood. 1, 2, 3.
Jiga. Oh, that's a good record.
Okay, so let's start then with Jiga, right?
Yeah.
Because you came off of having the quintessential wedding song, Kaifa song.
I'm a big wedding song guy.
And
I
then
like weddings.
But here's the thing, right? With a song like Jiga, does it then become formulaic? Like, let's create a wedding song.
No, not at all. It just follows me somehow. You know, also, you must understand, like, weddings in... The entire continent is like a very universal concept. Everybody likes to have a lit wedding, right?
Yeah.
And I've always found that, you know, one of my favorite things when people send me videos on social media of like people having their like first dance or like walking into the reception with my song, like that shit is the most gratifying thing for me. Cause that's like my mission, isn't it? For people, you know what, like New Year's, right?
Mm-hmm.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, Happy New Year. You see that song you play there. That is the aim of an artist, to make songs for moments, for birthdays, for weddings, for New Year's. So for me, it's Kaifa's song and Chiga. It just happens kind of by mistake. And it's whatever is meant to be will be. The music kind of just follows where I am. And when it happens, it just happens. There's absolutely no formula. I've never, ever gone into any session and said, you know, that's where people get it fucked up as well. They're like, yo, we need to make a, they used to call it a club banger. Mm-hmm. We need to make a club banger.
Yeah.
And when you try to make a club banger, you never, ever make a club banger.
Mm.
So you just gotta, like, if I'm in a sad, sad place in my life, I'll make sad music.
Okay.
If I'm happy, I make happy music, you know? So it's just a reflection. You know?
It mirrors your life. You know what song I like?
Yeah.
Magriza.
Yeah, that was a dope joint as well.
It's produced by Books, yeah?
Correct.
So yeah. How do you...
Ivy League, correct.
Papa. How do you then come back from... It's either us or, you know, your solo career as Ivy League, being kicked out of Ivy League to...
You like saying that, no?
Kicked out of Ivy League?
No, I was kicked out. It's almost like you get a
kick out of it.
You've said it too many times.
Okay, Askisa, it was the last time I'm saying it.
Yeah, please.
So, from that point to working together again, what did it take for you guys to get back together?
Not much.
Yeah?
Just time.
Mm-hmm.
Just time, and a year or two passed and whatever, and just called him. I said, yo, man, could you do something? Would you do a record for my album?
Yeah.
And he did.
Yeah. When I spoke to you... for Touch My Blood, you said there was this song that you wanted to put on the album and it had some soccer commentary.
Golazo. That song might still come out.
So why did it end up not being on the album?
Just sonically, it didn't fit.
Okay.
An album is a puzzle.
Uh-huh.
Every piece must fit together. Yeah.
Yeah.
It just didn't fit. Yeah.
Yeah. What was cool, I think, about Touch My Blood was it was... your first time stepping out on your own and releasing something under your own imprint, right?
Correct.
The Beam Group. And
that was a nervous scandal.
But the Beam Group started with a bang.
Ash, we had such good intentions, man.
Yeah. And then it kind of dissolved.
It didn't dissolve, it exploded.
Do you want to say why it exploded?
just nobody ever taught us how to run a business.
Yeah. But then you had to now... Not had to, but the next thing is you went back to working with Fifth Season, which you'd been very publicly disgruntled with.
You mend your bridges, man. Time goes on. You fix things.
Yeah.
I mean, Benza and Fifth Season, what they were always good at is what they do. They're good at releasing music, pushing music, promoting music. But this time it was going to be different.
Mm-hmm.
For the first time, the check was going to hit me in my pocket first.
Yeah.
Ding. Do you guys know that I only got control of my own money for the first time? What year is it now? 2020?
Mm-hmm.
1918, 2 years ago. That's crazy, right?
Yeah.
Before that, I was a manager. Oh, here, let me take my 20%. Here, what? Paying me, what? Like, man, like, I can't be somebody's father calling somebody asking, like, yo, can you send me 30K?
Yeah.
You know, and for me, that was also part of Touch My Blood. That's why it also came out the way it did, because now I was in control of my own money.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a very liberating thing. You know how long it takes for artists to get control of their own money? There's artists, amazing artists, still to this day, who still are not in control of their dough. It's not like you think it is.
Yeah.
People are still getting like salaries, managers. Like stealing this shit. Like, it's crazy.
Mm. And that narrative of controlling your money and just how many figures became a central part of your story after Beam Group. Because then You became the first African artist, right, to sign a 7-figure deal with Reebok. Yes, no?
Who's your sources?
Yes, no?
In trouble with the text, man. No, it wasn't. It wasn't. Was it 7-figure? What 7 figures? 1,000, 1,000.
Million. Yeah.
Or millions.
Yes, million.
Yeah. Isn't that 6-figure? 1. Anyway, whatever the fuck ever. So, yeah, that was cool. Yeah. Are you trying to say I made a lot of dough? Yes, I did. So.
So, being the first African artist, to sign a deal with them.
Booker Love used to have a deal, but his shit wasn't hot like this joint.
So this is where I'm
this
trying
shit
to
was,
get to.
This is the real joint.
So this is where I'm trying to get to, right? So a lot of people would have just taken the money and like been a face and wore the clothes and whatever.
Yeah.
But you actually got to pull out your own colorways.
Yeah.
So tell me a little bit about.
Oh, this shoe is actually. By the way, Balmain suck, nigga.
Cheers, sir.
This shoe is designed. The basis is the Dior Runner. Have you guys seen the Dior Runner? It's got like a luminous. So, I actually wanted to make it. Do you guys remember also the S. Dot Carter, the Reebok shoe? So that was my favorite shoe, and that was also a Reebok. So, you know, I actually designed this with my brother. So. They let me. This took about two years to come to fruition. Right?
Oh wow!
I remember I used to be like, oh man, I want my own sneaker. People were like, yeah, right. How are you gonna get your own sneaker? Because even me, I was like, yeah, how am I gonna get my own sneaker?
Yeah.
And eventually, you know, it happened. And this for me is one of my proudest achievements in my entire career, man. Like for me to have my own Reebok sneaker, I still pinch myself to this day. I cannot believe it, that I actually managed that these white people even gave me this opportunity. You know? I mean, thank you. Thank you. For me to get Reebok, this company, to actually do this with me was just crazy. So anyway, yeah. So we put like cheetah print inside.
Mm-hmm.
So like my mentality is like, you know, if we get an opportunity to do a sneaker like this with a global brand, like I want to put like things in there for people to know where I come from and, you know, Africa, whatever, you know, make it look a bit luxe, like a bit of luxury. So it's like the S. Dot Carter, it's like a Dior Nyana something, you know?
Yeah.
Instead of making it plain white, we made it like butter. It's like a reflector. Can you see this? Can you see when you flash it with the camera? It's got 3M on it.
Uh-huh.
I'm proud of this. This for me is just as good as Touch My Blood.
Oh, wow.
Maybe even better.
Okay.
For me, in my heart.
Yeah.
I mean, dog, I got my own sneaker. That's crazy, dude.
That's dope.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Did you end up sending Shane Eagle a pair?
No.
No?
Didn't we have beef as well?
You did.
We did, no.
You were really hard on him on the hustle.
Yeah, so? No, but he was actually my favorite.
Yeah.
He was actually my favorite. I think what Shane is doing now, and you know, Ish, I feel a bit swag that like I don't really, I need to make more music with more people, you know?
Yeah.
I really want to make a record with Shane and with the record will happen. Like, can you believe how long it took for me and Youngster to make a record?
Yep.
It took us like 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
But it did happen and it will happen. And, once again, I don't think Shane ever really hated me. I think he was just a bit chilly.
But send him some shoes. Make it right.
They sold out.
Ish, okay.
And then I got a dip in my own stash. Mm-hmm. And I've only got 3 pairs in my garage sitting there.
Yeah?
Yeah.
All your size?
A lot.
Okay. Ish, what can we say?
What you rocking over there? What you got? Some Reeboks?
Uh-huh.
All right, I see you.
I mean, but anyway, what I wanted to talk to you about, because I think this is a pretty big deal, is you actually dropped out of sound engineering school, right?
Yeah.
But then you went and established a scholarship with SAE in Cape Town.
Yeah. I did. Shit, I forgot about that.
And then you gave 100,000 rands towards Fees Must Fall.
Uh-huh.
And now you have... Your concert coming up.
We're postponing the concert though.
Oh yeah?
Yeah, I gotta get knee surgery.
Oh, what's wrong with your knee?
It's totally fucked up.
What did you do to it?
Vosho. No, seriously. That's how I injured my knee. I've got a cracked meniscus, what.
Okay, so when the information is ready about the concert, it'll be on all your pages,
yeah.
Basically. So you're turning 32 in a couple of days, right? Mm. And I think that the 30s are pretty phenomenal.
Yeah.
But what for you is one thing that the 30s has brought with it that you're like, I hate this? And what is thing
shit
one
like
thing
this.
Like the meniscus?
Yeah, like shit like what, this. What? I used to be able to drink and party like an animal.
Uh-huh.
Now I can't do it 2 days in a row.
Mm-hmm.
Wake up in the morning, oh my back. For real, it's a real thing. Like I wish I could party like I used to.
Yeah.
I just can't anymore.
Okay. What is the thing that you love that the 30s has brought with it?
Dough. Being able to do what I want, go where I want, and be able to take care of my family, take care of my daughter. I spoil my daughter. My daughter is the most spoiled person in the world.
Yeah.
She has everything that she wants. And just be able to just like take everything that's in my head. Like I always wanted to do like, oh, I need to make some t-shirts. You know what? I want to make some t-shirts. Like if I get an idea, I can execute it.
Yeah.
That's the best thing about where I am in my career.
Mm.
Like back in the day, if I wanted to like print some t-shirts, like, oh, where am I going to get the dough to do that?
Mm.
You know, and that's a problem that a lot of people face.
Yeah.
It's just one that I don't have anymore though.
Yeah.
And lots.
So I'm going to open it up to the floor for some questions.
His hand was up super fast.
I don't know how much time you have. We'll take a few.
I got as much. I was late, so.
Yeah.
Wow. So I'm going to take a few, and at some point I am going to have to cap it, so
that's
at least in advance. But we're going to.
Please, can you answer as many as possible?
Yes, we can answer as many as possible.
Do you mind?
I definitely don't mind. We're going to go to Bailwanster first, I think.
Do you mind?
Awe.
What's up, bro?
Compliments of the year, bro.
Thank you, sir.
Everyone, actually.
Compliments of the season. When is the cutoff point for like saying compliments?
January. Yeah.
End of March. Some niggas still be in like March, like compliments.
All right, then. Bro, first of all, big shout out, big respect for the Lurie's chat.
Thank you.
Insane.
Were you there?
He did. No, I just watched it.
Oh,
back
you watched
to back.
It?
Yeah. He did a Lurie's keynote, like from his artist perspective. What I thought was really cool about that is how you, for lack of a better term, stepped out of character. And then you spoke about the brand, AKA.
Yeah.
And like, AKA the villain and whatnot, you know. And how intentional
did
you
say
become.
The villain?
Yeah, that's what you did.
Mr. Powers. Yeah, I like that movie, know. Yeah.
So how intentional you've become with every move that you make, the brands you align with, you were dropping gems like crazy that day, you know, how challenger brands and how AKA the brand aligns with those. I thought that was cool. So that's a great segue to the question. At what point in your three eras, like albums, did you suddenly become more intentional about the brand AKA and decide, okay, we're a brand, this is who we align with, and who were you with? Because I know you're with Don Design now. So like, what influenced that, oh snap, we're a brand now?
I would definitely say it started with really, 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 really consciously. Probably touched my blood. Like now. Like I really took control of my own business, took control of my own money, and invested in people consciously, people that make me better. Graphics designers, band, you know what I'm saying? I will say yes. Levels. I think when I started a band, I think that's when was maybe the first step to say, okay, I want to play Opi Kopi. How am I gonna do it? Because I thought I needed a band. So me starting a band really enabled me to do like Rocking the Daisies, all that stuff. I think that might have been the first sign that, all right, I'm thinking about things on a different level. But in terms of my like brand, collabos and stuff like that, I definitely say like Touch My Blood era. Before that, like maybe 2017, I really started getting really switched on to how I really need to make money off. I don't want to gig forever, bro.
Yeah.
If I don't want to sit in another Viano, dog. Yo. You know what I mean? I love what I do when I'm on the stage, but the traveling, all of that stuff, it takes a lot out of me. So I needed to create opportunities and revenue streams for myself that if I don't want to perform, I don't have to perform.
Mm. Okay. How? Can we
finish up the AKA logo?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the logo, you've had it for a while. Like from L-Tido. So like, obviously that you came a lot. You already had
the, like the iconography.
Yeah, that's iconic, you know, and it's been there, which means you kind of had that mind.
Yeah, I kept it like we kept it. I don't even know who designed that logo.
Really?
Yeah.
Hi, my name
is... Has anybody ever told you look like RZA? Yeah.
RZA?
Don't you look like RZA from afar?
My question is very simple. When are we getting an AKA docu-series on Netflix or somewhere else or even on social media? Man.
Well, to tell you the truth, I'm actually working on something this year in that if I do a docu-series, it has to make me rich. Not YouTube.
Yeah.
Not Channel O. Not Netflix. No, I mean example. No, example. You know what I mean? I actually want to do... shit, I don't want to give the game away because the game is to be sold, not to be told. You know what I'm saying? I want to do a docu-series of myself, but it must be an app. You must subscribe to see it.
Don't you already have an app?
I do have an app, but... It's not popping. It's not popping. I mean, I make good money off of it, but money isn't everything. I want to have full control of it. I want people to be able to. I want people to know me, man. I think I get a raw deal. I think I'm like a nice guy. I think I'm a cool person.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that people like think I'm some sort of like dickhead or something. You know what I mean? And that's why I want to do a docu-series so that people can actually be like, man, I would love to be like just. Chill with this guy, know this guy.
Yeah.
And I think it's time for me in my career now where I want you guys to also not just know me through my music, but also know me like who I am. But here's the other problem with me doing a docu-series is, you know, when people do these reality shows or docu-series, they only show you the good side of themselves, mm-hmm. right? It's like Instagram. I think mine would be like, I also want you to see me like, in a bad light. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Because then you look at me as a human, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Like see me as a bad, my bad stuff as well. Which person, which docuseries and reality show do you any see or any of these celebrities' bad sides? They're always like so perfect.
Yeah. You want to put the real in reality.
You know what I'm saying? I want you to see me losing my shit, smacking niggas.
Oh, no, let's not do that anymore. we have another question.
Does it answer your question? So yes, this year. This year, yeah, it will happen this year. Yeah, it will. It will happen this year. Just stay tuned, man.
Sup, AKA?
Yes, sir.
My name is Louis V. I just want to ask...
Louis V?
Yeah.
I'm kind of Louis Vuitton, but my mom a purse. Now she Louis Vuitton mom.
Shout out. I just want to ask, man, like, compared to other industries, you know, like the music industry structure has been structured very, very badly. I just want to ask, like, what do you think that needs to be done, you know, to like to change this whole thing? Because, you know, the artist is always like the last person to be paid.
Yes, sir.
And you find that you as an artist, you are the business, but you find that you have a CEO.
100%.
And you should be the CEO, and then you have like the managing employee. So I just want to ask, like, what do you think should be done, like from like now to like the next 10 years? Should we stick to the same structure, or should like people, like musicians, should be radical about this whole thing, and start like? And I just want to also ask that. Okay, no, I'm not going to ask that, but yeah, it's cool. I'm just.
Thank you.
Good question, Louis V. It's the oldest story of all time. Artist is hungry. Artist wants to get on. Artist gets signed, doesn't read the contract. Artist makes $1 million. Artist gets fucked. Artist falls out with their label. You've heard this story a billion times, but artists are still doing it, right? I think now we need to take advantage of technology. You do not need a record label to get your shit on iTunes. You don't. You do not need You do not need to sign any contract of any sort to get your music out there to the people. If you got social media, if you can, you know, do your own gigs. Like, do you remember Puma Social Club?
Mm-hmm.
That shit was lit. Do you remember those days? Like, you can still do that shit. Like, you can build a cult following. You guys heard of Russ, right?
Yeah.
He's like one of the richest guys in the game. And he's like doing his own shit. So it depends, man. Like, what are you after? Because, man, let me tell you, these dudes come through and then you, you got a meeting at Sony. You know, you get there and it's, oh, let's have a meeting in the Michael Jackson room. Oh, you want, what do you want? You want to do cappuccino? You know?
Yeah.
And then you sit there and then they tell you they're going to do all of this stuff. Let me tell you something, bro. They never really, nobody really ever keeps their promises in this industry. I think right now, young people need to put their faith in technology, put their faith into social media, put their faith into information, and put their faith in each other.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sure. I'm going to take four more questions, and I'm going to prioritize the women in the room. So I'm going to come to the women in a
come
bit,
on,
but
this guy's dying. I'm dying to hear what this
No, but two people already have mics. So after those two people, I'm prioritizing women. So hope.
What up, bro?
What's up, bro?
Easy. I've got two questions. One,
yes, sir.
What inspired the BMF remix? Because like I heard that and that I was like spazzing.
I think a big Miss Jacob Zuma.
And I actually saw you perform it at Back to the City for the first time.
Oh, Back to the City. Remember back in the days when I used to perform at Back to the City?
Back in the days.
Yeah.
But I'm saving myself for Back to the City. Me and Osmic are actually pretty cool. All right,
that's pretty dope. Cool.
They're going to bring me back. Sorry, I'm talking. You're supposed to be talking.
That's chill. The second question would be like on an artist development point of view, like is it like are you looking to sign anyone in
never.
The future?
I'm never going to sign anyone ever.
Okay.
What a headache it is to sign an artist. You're responsible for their rent, their petrol money, their drip, everything. You know, I don't think I'll ever start a record label, man. I mean, what I got to do? Shoot a video for you? Nah, nigga, I need to shoot my own shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm just too selfish to go shoot you a video. And go shoot your own fucking video.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That's my mentality.
BMF?
I used to do these little mixtape joints all the time, drop them. I think one of the parts, one of the reasons I'm also very big today is because I was one of the first artists to latch onto Twitter. I was probably one of the first artists to latch onto Twitter in South Africa and make it like a big story. So I used to do those drops, BMF. Yeah, it was cool, man. It was just something to just keep me busy and just to keep people interested.
Yeah.
People always got to do shit like that. Still to this day, people still do remixes and, you know, drops and whatever.
Yeah. There's a question over there.
Thank you. Yo, what's up, man?
Bro?
Yo, it's P-Dog Amazing. Please say the amazing. It's a question for artist development, I guess.
Oh my God, guys, do you all want to know artist development?
Yes, let them ask.
We must have a workshop, man.
Let us do our thing. I want to know about balance, right? A lot of artists, they hear you saying like the game is edgy, the game needs beef, the people thrive off drama and whatever the case may be. And you get some artists who are like genuinely nice, like they just, they want world peace, basically.
Yeah,
you know
what
I mean? So how do you like create that balance and still be appealing to the market? Especially if you're maybe an artist like myself who came close to making a break in the industry. The song's called Unbelievable. It was part of a group called Palm Tree Paradise from Durban. We're amazing at some point. And then we got fucked over repeatedly by people who made us promises, made us sign things, and everyone was disgruntled, and all of a sudden it was over. You know what I mean? So like for someone like myself who doesn't believe on like stepping on people, there's so many people who I see even every day, even on TV or whatever, who stood in front of you and you still have the SMS to them lying to you and doing bad things. So like how do you strike that balance, man, and still maintain some peace with yourself as an artist? Thank you very much.
Good question. The first thing I want to tell you is it's never over. You didn't used to be awesome at any time. You still are. It's never over, bro. As long as you're alive, you still have an opportunity to do whatever the fuck you want to do, right? So that's the first rule. It's never ever, right? Also, you asking me about peace? Are you asking me about peace, balance? Here, let me tell you something about the game. There is no fucking balance and there is no fucking peace. There is no peace. Don't get it twisted. Like, inner peace and balance is something that you might chase for your whole life. I still have no peace, inner peace. I have no balance. So it's all about what do you want out of life, man? Like, what do you want out of life? Also, if you're not the type of person to be able to deal with this type of life that you're going to have to live, then don't do it. Go do something else, bro.
For sure.
Go do something else. But if this is what you really want to do, I'm not saying you can't be a nice guy. I'm not saying you can't be a good person and thrive in the industry, because you can. But you're going to have to get some people around you to be assholes so that you can be a nice guy. Do you know what I'm saying? Yeah. You're going to have to find some people to do the dirty, because this game is dirty work, bro. It's dirty, 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 dirty work. And also, it's not normal. Fame is not a normal thing. Who the fuck wants to walk in the mall and have people
stare at them?
It's not normal, right? What kind of impact can that have on your mentality, on your spirituality? Do you know what I'm saying? But if you make music your peace, and your music gives you your sanity, there's many different ways to do it, you know? So you don't have to be an animal, but you're gonna need some animals around you.
Yeah. Cool. There's a young lady over there. Sure, ask your question. If it's an artist development question.
Come on, brother, let's go. Bro.
Shout out to Helen.
Sean Jayami.
Yeah. Hey, Kiernan. If I remember well, some time ago, if my mind serves me very well.
but your mic technique, my brother,
Okay. Didn't you have some brands of your own with some headset?
Yes, I did.
When Dre was...
Rocker.
Yeah, what happened?
Didn't make any dough off of it, man.
Okay.
It was controlled by someone else. It wasn't controlled by me.
Oh.
It was some other, you know, people come to you with deals sometimes, and then they make the deal over there. They sign it and what, and then they tell you, yo, we're going to send you the cheese. Then they send you the cheese, and it's not the cheese they told you they're going to send, you know. Then eventually you're just like, But, you know, you also have lots of, experience, I've had lots of ventures that I've tried, you fail. Some work out, some don't, you know?
And funny enough, this morning I was there at the engineering school. They talked about
you. At ASC?
Now the engineering school at the broadcasting.
Yeah, water. At ASC here by SBC?
Yeah.
This looks like a spaceship.
They said some nice stuff about you.
All right, thank you. Can you pass the mic to the lady at the back?
Yeah, look, for me, I went to sound engineering school because I needed to give my parents an excuse to sound like I was busy doing something. But I wasn't really. All I wanted to do was learn how to do Pro Tools. When they started teaching me about fucking rolling cables and shit, that's when I was like, if I end up rolling cables, like, this is not what I want to do. I didn't sign up for this shit.
Yeah.
Soldering irons. Because I'm bad with, like, you know, that type of shit. All I wanted to do was learn how to work and record and work Pro Tools. But ASE was good. You know what the most valuable thing about ASE is? Is where it is. Across the road is the SABC. That is a building full of artists, DJs, producers.
Studios.
Jobs, studios. I, after my first year, I was like, what the fuck am I doing on this side of the road? I should be over there. And that's where I went to got my first job and so forth and so forth.
Cool. We have our last question. Is it an artist development question?
Brand development.
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
Hi. Muleni.
Hello.
I've got two questions for you. One.
Yes, ma'am.
What do you know now that you wish you knew way early in your career when it comes to building your brand?
Correct.
And then the second question is, what do you do or what qualities do you possess to sustain your longevity in the industry?
In the industry.
Yes. When it comes to your brand and staying relevant and maintaining the status of excellence.
Well, that's a great question. The first question is a great, great question in that, what do I wish I knew? What What do I wish I knew? Only everything. You know, like, I wish I knew that, shit, man, you actually stumped me. What do I wish I knew? Can you give me 10 seconds?
Sure.
I wish.
While he's doing the 10 seconds. Oh, of silence. Oh, okay. Let's be in silence.
Hey, don't rush. Don't rush, genius. You know what? I actually don't have an answer for that question. What do I wish I knew?
I was about to say, if you...
Oh, yes, yeah. What do I wish I knew? Don't trust people with your money. Just don't, man. And save your money. Save your money. Save your money. Save your money. You know, be better with your money and also be more wary of your business and your money. Don't let, you know, artists dispatch like walls around them. So we build like, oh, you, the manager. And managers, sometimes they get, especially when you're a manager to a great artist,
mm-hmm.
You start thinking you're that artist, but you're not the artist. The artist is the artist, but the artist is so busy, like just living life, you know, my manager, call my manager. Speak to my manager.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, the manager is the one making all the plugs with the brands, having all the meetings, building all the relationships, all the networking, and should you and that manager part, you've just spent 5 years in the industry and you ain't got one contact to your name. Why?
Yeah.
Because your manager spent 5 years making all the plugs. That I wish I knew. Second thing. what sustains me? Passion, 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 pushing passion. Passion fruit and lemonade. passionate, man. I know it's a bit corny, it's a bit like Disney World, but for me, the opportunity to be a better version of myself every day. You know what my favorite thing is waking up in the morning. I just love like, oh, a new day, you know? Like, I hate nighttime. Nighttime is so like final, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's dark, you know, go to bed.
Yeah.
You know? I get a lot of energy from just having the opportunity to do better, make more money, make more impact, make better music, push myself further. How big of an LED can we get? You know, like how big can you make the screen behind me? Like how where can I go? You know, like just you have to have a lust and a love for life. And passion, man. You know, keep the main thing the main thing. Take care of the music.
Yeah.
No, keep the main thing the main thing. Artists get so like all over the place. Oh man, I gotta get the right photographer. You know, I gotta get it the best. You know, fuck all that shit. Keep the main thing the main thing. The music.
Thing.
The music will take care of you. If you take care of the music will take care of you.
For sure. Before we wrap up, the president of the Mega C would like to ask a question.
You didn't talk about your upcoming concert.
Ufiz.
Yes.
We did. You were out getting the Zimbas. But on that note, Zola's going to come forward because I think the biggest thing that...
Why do I feel like y'all are about to give me like a plaque or something?
Sort of. So the thing that I enjoy most...
Sorry.
Can you pay attention?
Sorry.
The thing that I enjoy most about your career is consistency. Like, you are consistent in your work, you're consistent in your attitude, you are consistent. And we would like to give you your flowers while you can still smell them.
Nice.
And we appreciate you, and I hope you feel the love, and don't drop our mic there.
Can I stand up?
Sure.
Mm.
So we hope you feel the love, man.
Nice. I just want to say, first and foremost, it's very nice to be me.
Mm-hmm.
I just want to say that you have been my favorite and most amazing. I wouldn't even call you a journalist. You know, you're more than that to this. Don't want to feel like a honey while I'm talking to you with these flowers. I just feel like, you know, you have been so instrumental in my career. You've always given me a fair deal. You've never been scared to tell me what you think of this or that. You've never never given me a raw deal. You've always given me a good chance to express myself. And I just want to say this is such an amazing platform. And I really, really wish you like the world of the best, because this is some real, real sick shit that you're doing. And you made me drive all the way from Bryanston to be here, which is really far.
Thank you.
And I just want to say, we love you, man. We love you, Helen. Thank you for everything you're doing for the game.
Thank you very much. Can you sit for 2 seconds? Thank you.
Thank you. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. So just sit for 2 seconds, because I do want to say thank you very much to all of you for coming through today. This will be up on youtube.com/Helen Herimbi.
Was this a good one?
It was amazing. It's going to be up on the YouTube.
Was it
please,
the best one?
Please hit subscribe and give me a subscription over there. Our next Imbali Live is on the 2nd of February. Super legendary guest that we've got coming. Soon. We'll have him soon. And then I also want to thank Zola and the mixologist and the video production and the sound desk and Gizo and everybody who makes sure that Imbali is as incredible as
it is.
That it? And I want to give it up to AKA one more time. Thank you.
Is the bar still open?
No, the bar is closed.
The bar's closed?
Go home. I'm kidding. I don't know. Zola is going to tell us. No, I think.